Pound the rock.
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 Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and welcome to Montana Tech's Bob Green Field at Alumni Coliseum for today's Frontier Conference action. Today's game features the Rocky Mountain College Battling Bears and your Montana Tech Ore Diggers. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Montana Tech Pep Band under the direction of Dr. Pete Knutson.
I feel chatty today, so I think I'm just going to talk the whole time.
Woo! Just like that.
Check out Digger Vision for today's starters. Brought to you by Montana Orthopedics. Let's meet this afternoon's starting lineups for your Montana Tech Ore Diggers. A defensive back from Compton, California. Number one, Andre Brown. Starting linebacker from Wichita, Kansas. Number four, Brock Polley. starting in defensive back from Kalispell, number 6, Reed Siderius.
Starting defensive back from Kalispell, number 22, Tucker Routh. Linebacker from Helmville, number 29, Danny Mannix. Defensive back from Helena, number 30, Dan Van Dyke. Starting linebacker from Kootenai, Idaho, number 38, Paul Sundquist. On the defensive line from Joliet, number 45, Brock Beattie. Starting linebacker from Gardner, number 47, Connor Wines. The defensive line from Helena, number 55, Tyler Sanders. On the defensive line from Idaho Falls, number 99, Chance Hansen. Kicker and the punter from Renton, Washington is number 40, Derek Holt. Quarterback from Manhattan, number 8, Quinn McQuarrie. Starting wide receiver from Red Lodge, number 10, Sean Sullivan. Running back from Harrison, number 28, Chad Fike. And running back from Plain City, Utah, number 43, Braxton Porter. On the offensive line from Billings, number 57, Jalen Whitley. Offensive line from Olalla, Washington, number 66, Nate Young. On the offensive line from Steele, North Dakota, number 70, Grant Benz. Offensive lineman from Moscow, Idaho, number 73, Kellen Davis. Offensive lineman from Billings, number 78, Trevor Hopp. Wide receiver from Fairfield, California, number 81, Deion Williams. Tight end from Sacramento, California, number 80, Hunter Clark.
Today's officials is signed by the Frontier Conference. A great Tuttle, Chris Connell, Kevin Leishman,
Scott Orr, Dan Bueller, Jay Gomiza, and Spencer Mumford.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more time, the Montana Tech Pep Band. Please bring your attention to the north end zone. We would like
to welcome
today's
game day VIPs. Montana Tech Foundation would like to thank all these individuals for their dedication to Montana Tech and the Butte community. If you know someone who deserves to be a game day VIP, please contact Peggy McCoy, 406-496-4402. Montana Tech welcomes all players, officials, and spectators to this afternoon's contest. As a member of the NAIA and the Frontier Athletic Conference, we are committed to the true spirit of competition by being a champion of character through the five core character values the NAIA embraces, which are respect, integrity, responsibility, servant leadership, and sportsmanship. We ask each of you as a participant, official, or spectator to abide by these values by creating a positive environment in which our athletes may participate, our officials may work, and you, the spectator, may enjoy. Please enjoy this afternoon's contest. Montana Tech would like to remind fans to always show good sportsmanship. Racial or sexist slurs, profanity, or any action that endangers the safety of the players, coaches, officials, administrators, or fans will not be tolerated. Frontier Conference would like to thank the following corporate sponsors for their continued support. D.A. Davidson, the official financial services firm of the Frontier Conference. EBMS, the official healthcare provider of the Frontier Conference. McDonald's, the official restaurant chain of the Frontier Conference and also supporting throughout the Frontier Conference region. Pepsi, the official soft drink company of the Frontier Conference. The official hotel of the Frontier Conference. And U.S. Bank, the official bank of the Frontier Conference. Visit the Frontier Conference website at www.frontierconference.com to get all of the updated scores and information, along with viewing a listing of our many Friends of the Frontier sponsors, along with consulting fan travel and making your hotel reservations when your team is on the road playing the other cities in the Frontier Conference. One more time, ladies and gentlemen, the Montana Tech Pep Band under the direction of Dr. Pete Knutson.
We'll be right back.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pioneer Technical brings you the greatest door dinger of all time. Ladies and gentlemen, War Digger fans, this is our place. This is Bob Green Field at Alumni Coliseum. This is Hallowed Ground. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your Montana Tech War Digger!
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand by for a word from Mariah's Challenge founder, State Farm agent Leo McCarthy, in this week's Montana Tech Welcome.
Hello, Digger fans. This is Leo McCarthy, your local State Farm agent and founder of Mariah's Challenge. This weekend is the anniversary of the tragedy, but it's 10 years of helping youth grow old, giving over $300,000 in scholarships. Please have a designated sober driver this weekend and enjoy the festivities. We'd like to thank the game day sponsors, Anderson Zermulin, Thriftway, Tucker Transportation, and Pioneer Technical. Hope you enjoy the game today, and go Diggers!
The Ore Diggers thank Zip Beverage for being the official sponsor of the Montana Tech Tailgate. We would also like to thank tonight's tailgate partner, Montana Tech's Touchdown Club. Let's hear it for our corporate partners. Ladies and gentlemen, time, please continue standing and remove your hats to honor our great nation as former Montana Tech football player Andy Larson sings our country's national anthem.
Dawn's early.
Montana Tech alumni Mike McGivern. Mike graduated with a degree in occupational safety and health in 1988 and is the Vice President of Human Resources at Montana Resources right here in Butte. Montana Resources and the Dennis and Phyllis Washington Foundation have partnered with Montana Tech to establish the Montana Resources Opportunity Scholarship. This scholarship was established to help students who graduate from high school in Butte and who have financial need be the first in their family to attend college. Mike and the rest of the Montana Resources team believe in the transformational change that education can bring about and understand there is no better school than Montana Tech to help change economic fortunes. A big thank you to Montana Resources for putting more of Butte's young people on the path to their own extraordinary futures. Mike is married to Carol McGivern, who is also an ore digger. Carol has a degree in occupational safety and health and a master's in industrial hygiene. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike McGivern.
Rocky Mountain, you are the visitors today, and you'll be calling the coin toss. Montana Tech, this is the Frontier Conference coin. Frontier Conference is heads. Universal Awards out of Billings, Montana, is tails. You're going to call the toss. You're going to flip it in the air and land it on the ground. What are you going to call? He calls tails. Mike? It's tails. Rocky Mountain has won the toss, and they're deferring their choice in the second half. You want the ball? Which way you want to kick? Let's turn around. Montana Tech will be receiving at this end. Good luck, Ben.
Right, tell them what we're doing.
Oh man, it's gonna be great. Tell them what's up, Jimbo.
All right, we're gonna put a big ol' battling bear right on Tech's field.
Did you hear something?
What's that? I told you, dude. Nothing here.
Oh, yeah, dude. There's nothing here.
All right, fine. Let's go. Let's go finish this paint job.
All right.
This is how bears blow.
Ah! Oh god! No! No!
Oh no!
Ah!
I hate Rocky. I shouldn't have gone to Rocky. They should have been here, Tech, the whole time.
Across the 25-30, out to the 33-yard line. It looked like line, and that is the case. So Levi Line with the return. And this Rocky team is one you have to watch for on special teams. They are incredibly good in the special teams games. We did see, kind of the short kick. You'll see an onside kick at times. You'll see them fake punts. It sounds like they had an amazing fake punt against Southern Oregon. They had the ball in, like, their 15-yard line on, like, 4th and 14, and they converted a fake punt. You're going to have to watch for them in special teams in a big way. So here come the digs. As Ron Haskett mentioned, over 600 yards of offense average on the year. Four receivers, one back. McQuarrie looking to throw on first down. The streak to the tight end across the 40, 35 down the right side. That's Fike. Fike at the 15 to the 12-yard line.
You know, Montana Tech will spread you out, and that time they had Fike in the backfield. And, two to the right, two to the left, and you know, they run whatever combination of stuff they run on the outside. And they must have picked something up on film. Who's picking Fike up out of the background or backfield? We Fike run the sideline and the flat route stuff. That time they just check angled him, ran him right up the seam.
It looked like such a tight end go that I thought it was to Osborne. Fike will get the carry this time, and he'll be taken down at the line of scrimmage, no gain. So Fike on the first play from scrimmage gets a big one. And Montana Tech looking at first, now second and 10 from the Rocky Mountain College 11-yard line. They'll say he gained a yard on the carry.
Rocky rushes four to start that game, and you always got to be careful with Ryder Rice, the big outside linebacker, defensive end. He's a monster of a guy, and he's given Tech some headaches in the last couple games.
Second and 9, rifle shot into the end zone, tipped and incomplete. They were looking for the curl route about 3 yards into the end zone. They had what they wanted, but well defended. They were looking for Sean Sullivan. That one's tipped to the turf. That'll bring up third down. You bring up a great one at Ryder Rice. He and Feisthamel were playing companions in Savage. That's saying something when you get two guys out of a six-man roster playing on Saturdays.
Pretty good batting percentage there for that high school program.
Third and 9, and Rocky wants a timeout. Boy, the coaches came running out on the field to call that timeout. We'll go ahead and keep her here as they did not like what they saw there. So Montana Tech hits a 56-yarder to Jed Fike as they have the football down at the Rocky 11-yard line.
Yeah, I like what Montana Tech does down on the goal line. You know, they run a lot of stuff, say, inside the 10, 15-yard line. You know, you get down there, and so often you see teams either running fade routes or they'll run something skinny down the middle like a tight end, you know, control between the hashes. But Montana Tech, you know, they combine that scheme. You know, they'll get guys running seam down the middle or fade routes. We saw them successful running a couple fade routes both to the inside slot and the outside receiver against Northern. But what I like that they do, they run a lot of square out stuff in the end zone too. And in that previous down, you know, Rocky defended it well. But they just ran about a 10-yard square out with Sean Sullivan and Chris Kelly in the end zone. I mean, it's just, you know, what it tells me is they utilize the full 10 yards of the end zone, and it's just another, I mean, it's just another yard line to them. I mean, and so they will square people out in the end zone, and Rocky defended it really well.
Third down and 9 after the timeout. Here come the digs out offensively. Two receivers left, two to the right.
I was never confident calling that stuff, that square out stuff in the end zone, because all I could ever picture was somebody stepping in front of it and picking it off.
Four receivers, one back at home. McQuarrie dropping back, looking for the Chris Kelly in the end zone. Touchdown to Chris Kelly. Boy, he laced that thing in there. That's a great pass from McQuarrie to Chris Kelly, and Chris Kelly's going to get the points.
That is an incredible route. Kelly just running a quick little 5-yard post, and Rocky defended it well. I never got the number of the defender, but a defender crossed Kelly's face there. McQuarrie stuck it in, but Rocky brought a lot of pressure, and they had someone right in Quinn McQuarrie's grill as he delivered that football on target. He took a hit, but credit that, you know, the experienced quarterback standing in there taking the shot but delivering a catchable ball.
Quinn McQuarrie's 22nd touchdown throw of the year, Chris Kelly's 5th, and the kick is up and through. 7-0 as Montana Tech grabs the opening lead on their opening drive. 13:53 left to play here in this first quarter. We'll take a break. Rocky will get the football after this 1-minute timeout.
When Montana Tech was being formed, there was this huge need for engineering in the mines in particular. And in 1904, we had our first 10 graduates. And this spring, I'm going to have the opportunity to shake hands of over 500 extraordinary graduates whose lives have been changed because of Montana Tech. That problem-solving capability has expanded to include energy, ecology and restoration, business land management, trades and technical, nursing and health programs. Whatever the problem is, Montana Tech is the solution.
Points on the board in their opening drive. Low line drive kickoff, fielded at the 7, return across the 20, out near the 25, running room to the 29-yard line. And with the return there for the Battling Bears is going to be Lucas Overton. Overton, the freshman out of Idaho. And so for the Battling Bears, they'll be led out by Drew Korf. Drew Korf will run the offense as he had been seeing time throughout the weeks, but with the injury to Jacob Bakken, the tall quarterback out of Weibo, I believe an ACL is what I was told, he is out for the year, and that brings Drew Korf in. He's a freshman out of Boise, Idaho, 6'1", a buck 85. And, of course, Rocky will run that three-headed beast at tailback. We'll see three different guys in, and all three of them are very, very capable. Hand off to Melby. Melby tries to turn the corner. He'll get 5 on first down. And that is one of those guys at tailback. As we take a look at some of the numbers for Rocky, three guys, Sam Sparks, 94 carries for 540 yards. Mason Melby has 87 carries for 522 yards on the year. And then you have Jade Olson with 45 carries for 258. So all very capable runners for the Battling Bears. Second and 4 as Korf out of the shotgun. Looking left, rifle shot underthrown as the receiver tried to come back for it, and that's going to fall incomplete. Bring up 3rd and 4 here for the Bears.
Yeah, they were going for Jenkins, yep. Just trying to square him out, or or just run a stop. And, you know, they had him split out with Andre Brown. Andre Brown did a nice job, never really got out of his back pedal. Stayed his crouch, reacted to the football, but Rocky on first down going outside zone to the boundary side and caught Montana Tech in a little bit of a stunt.
Wow.
Montana Tech kind of collapsed that boundary side.
They're going to come out in the Wildcat, and Jenkins is going to take the snap. Jenkins out of the shotgun. It looked like they might have got started early, and that will be the case. The quarterback came all the way out to the wide side, and Jenkins was going to take the direct snap, and we're going to get flags of plenty. Boy, talking to Coach Morrell yesterday about Jenkins, he used about every positive word you can imagine for this kid. I mean, he's like he's a monster. You know, you look at him on paper, Jenkins, 6'5", 250 out of California. He's like he's fast. He is strong as you can imagine. And he is one that certainly is on the radar here for Montana Tech defensively.
And he must be trustable. You know, you put someone back there to handle the football from the snap. I mean, it just, you know, that tells you a few more things. Got to be a smart football player, and you got to be able to trust judgment.
So after the 5-yard penalty, third down and 9, and now we're going to get a whistle from the far linesman. And a stoppage of play for a moment.
Oh, they reset the clock.
Okay, so they reset the game clock. Third down and 9 here for the Battling Bears. Ball at their 31-yard line. Bears wearing white jerseys, green pants, and the white helmets. Montana Tech green jerseys, white pants, and the green helmets. Third down and 9. Blitz is coming from the edge. He's hit but delivers downfield. First down yardage. They get it out. Looks like Shinola with the catch. Shinola will move the chains for the Bears as he is out to the 46-yard line. That's a gain of 16. And boy, Korf took a heck of a shot from the near side, but delivered that football.
Working one-on-one against Jalen Johnson, and he just, you know, he ran about a 10-yard square in. A good job by Korf standing in there and, you know, letting his receiver get into his break and separate and let him, you know, kind of into the inside and then maybe a little shallow so his man could react to that football and separate.
First down and 10 from the 47-yard line. Man in motion. They're going to hand it off inside to Sparks. Sparks bounces it off tackle. He's across the 50. Montana Tech 45 to the 44. That's a gain of nearly 9 on first down.
Left side of that Rocky Mountain College line is doing a really good job of blocking the zone running attack. That time, you know, both sides or both Rockies outside zone runs have been to the boundary side or the short side. And behind that left side, and they've done a nice job of getting the edge for their running back.
Second down and 1 here for the Bears. Ball at the Montana Tech 44, and they're going to run that Wildcat with Jenkins. Jenkins out of the shotgun. He'll keep it. He gets hit in the backfield, and he's going to lose yards. He gets swarmed to as Montana Tech gets a bunch of bodies there, and Pauly is one of the first to make contact.
Yeah, Jenkins, meet Brock Pauly, the you know, sizable, athletic outside linebacker from Montana Tech. He stepped up in the hole, and next thing you know, Jenkins was standing back 2 yards. Pauly squared him up and blasted him backwards.
Third down and 3 here for the Battling Bears as they look to the sidelines. The first offensive possession for the Bears. They come in 4-3 in conference. Their hopes of winning the conference kind of went south with a loss to Carroll a week ago. Third down and 3.
See how Rocky's offensive front chooses to block. I think he's the conference's leading sack man, Connor Wines.
Korf will hand it off to Sparks. Sparks straight ahead. He's across the 40 to the 39-yard line. That's first down yardage. On 3rd and 3, he gets 5.
Active defense like Montana Tech that likes to get upfield, especially in that situation. You think a team's maybe throwing the ball. You pin your ears back. Rocky comes back with counter sweep, pulls a... I don't know if it was an inside slot or certainly the guard to the wide side and got a kick out for Sparks, the running back, but a nicely designed play.
First down and 10 for the Bears. This offensive line is all new, but they're all transfers from some big programs, and they have had a good year. First and 10. Two receivers right, one of the lefts, and tight end in motion right to left with one back lined up in the pistol. Montana Tech showing blitz. Handoff will go to the tailback. Left side across the 35, vaults to the 30 with the carry is going to be Sam Sparks.
They're seeing some daylight to the boundary side against this Montana Tech offense. No doubt about it. That time was inside zone to the wide side, but the quick windback to the boundary side that time provided some daylight for the running back.
This Rocky team has been very run-oriented throughout the year, but it feels like each and every week as the year continues, they get even more so. You know, the first time these two teams played, they were about 60-40 run to pass, and that number has gone even heavier toward the run as the year goes for the Bears.
They have a chip on their shoulder, too. They were held out of the end zone against Carroll College last week.
Second down and one. Handoff will go inside, and not much there for Sam Sparks, but the initial spot looks like he should have first down yardage.
First down yardage and maybe an inch or two more. Met in the hole that time by Montana Tech inside linebacker Nick Amistoy. Good tackle by Amistoy. Got underneath the running back, got into his legs and flipped him over on his back, but not until after he got that first down yardage.
First down and 10 here for the Bears. Quickly up to the line of scrimmage, the freshman Drew Korf out of the shotgun. Korf has one back lined up in the pistol. That's Sparks. One receiver each way, twin tight. Snap is low. Korf is able to dig it up. He wants the deep ball slant through the middle. His receiver hit him in the hands, and he can't hold on to it, as Shinola had points if he can bring that in.
Dream ball for a receiver. You get Montana Tech in zero man coverage. He's one-on-one against,
It was Brewer, wasn't it?
Yeah, Devonnie Brewer. And he had a step or two on him. The ball was perfectly placed down the middle of the football field and not able to rake it in for 6 points. A sure touchdown that time. You just hold on to the ball.
Second down and 10 here for the Battling Bears. Two receivers on each side of the formation. Ball at the Montana Tech 28-yard line. Diggs put three down, and they creep up from the inside. Sparks left side finds a hole. 20-15. Sparks gets it left, and he's hauled down at the 10-yard line. That's a great spurt, but this is probably coming back as there's a flag down at the original line of scrimmage.
Yeah, May comes up and makes the tackle from safety there. Otherwise, Sparks is standing in the end zone, but looks like this is in that holding area, and yes, it is.
So a big-time hold on the inside. Those seem to help the rushing yards a little bit at times, you know. Those holes kind of open up a little bit bigger when those are there. So that'll come back 10. Boy, Sparks is fast. You know, this young man really gets – he's one of those guys out of Billings Senior that seems to get to full speed instantly. You know, it doesn't take much for him to really be moving downhill.
Yeah, you can clearly see him once he made the break on that previous run to the outside. I mean, he's running away from Montana Tech defenders who are fast, by the way. You know, they're not just sizable guys. Those guys can pick him up and put them down.
Second and 20, Jenkins in motion to the right side. Trips receivers right. Montana Tech showing pressure. Here comes the blitz, and they're going to run screen on the inside to Sparks, who can't hold on to it.
You have to officiate that, too. I mean, that's clearly a back screen, but Sparks is 2 yards past the line of scrimmage. With that, with offensive linemen, I mean, you got your pick of penalties there. You've got illegal man downfield. You've got offensive pass interference. You've got to officiate that. You know, when Sparks made contact with that ball, he was standing right on the 35-yard line. Yep. That's 3 yards past the line of scrimmage.
Third down and 20 here for the Bears. They'll send three receivers left, one to the right. One back at home for Drew Korf. Montana Tech leads 7-0 with 8:45 left to play here in the opening quarter. Korf out of the shotgun. It's been a long drive here for the Bears. Korf, three-step drop, looking right. Has time, airs it up downfield, and it's up and incomplete at the 20-yard line. Shinola, the intended target. And Montana Tech's Jalen Johnson was there defensively.
Shinola wanted the pass interference there, but Jalen Johnson went up through him on his way to the football. A little bit of contact, but a good no call there on the deep, you know, the corner route or the deep sideline route.
So that will bring up fourth down, and the punting unit comes in here for the Bears. So again, be careful with this special teams unit as Rocky will try and pull out all the stops.
Montana Tech has nobody back to field this punt. They're just wary of a possible fake.
So the snap is a good one, and a high kick, wobbly spiral inside the five, bounces at the two and jumps over the bullets downfield into the end zone for a very lucky touchback for Montana Tech.
Huge break for Montana Tech. That punt is going to net out at less than 20 yards. Montana Tech will get the ball on the 20-yard line here, but a huge break.
I love Butte. It's my hometown. I was born and raised here, and definitely part of my soul is here. At Montana Tech, we receive this world-class education that I don't feel a lot of other students receive, and it's so valuable and it's so affordable, so I think that it's a really big benefit to students that come here. When I came to Montana Tech, I definitely felt inspired to work harder because you're surrounded by all of these incredibly hardworking people that are goal-oriented and they know exactly what they want to do. I think that just the type of students that get recruited here are your driven, really pretty bright students, and when we all get in a room together, we just vibe off of each other and it makes something really incredible. In preparing for dental school, I feel that I've gotten the best education possible through Montana Tech, and I feel well prepared, and I think that I have my advisors and my professors standing behind me, willing to help me.
Disco Ron Haskett, 8:31 left to play here in this opening quarter. Montana Tech leads 7-0. The Digs have run four offensive plays for 67 yards. Rocky, that was an 11-play drive, no points. First down and 10. McQuarrie, play takes his time, rifles it through the middle. It's tipped and caught at the 27-yard line. Tip drill, and Montana Tech gets that completion somehow. As the tip drill is up in the air, it looked like Rocky had hands on it initially, and Deion Williams makes the catch.
He tried to jam in that skinny little slant route, I think it was Sullivan, Deshaun Sullivan. The ball glanced up in the air, and it looked like, you know, any number of Rocky Mountain players could grab it. And Deion Williams just jumped in there, made the catch. A good break for Montana Tech, but no, that's Deion.
Yep.
That's Deion. I mean, he knows how to go get the football in any situation.
A gain of 7 on the tip drill. They'll run screen out to Sean Sullivan. Sullivan finds a seam. He's out to the 30. That's first down yardage. As that started right on the 20-yard line, all they needed to do was break the paint.
Real good job up front that time by Deion Williams. And it looked like Chris Kelly, they had three receivers out here. A lot of Rocky bodies getting to that, you know, just that quick little wide receiver screen. And they went helmet for helmet. Rocky got a safety up to make the tackle, but Sullivan got the first.
Three receivers left for McQuarrie. Fike in the backfield. They wanted to go screen again. Now they're looking deep ball down to Deion. Deion up, and it's picked off at the 35-yard line. That's a marvelous catch that time out there at corner as Kendall Jefferson gets the interception, and Rocky will get the football back.
Would have took a good effort to get the completion there. Jefferson is in great position, but that is how you play. You know, the go route or whatever. Jefferson gets his eyes to the quarterback and gets himself positioned, went up high point with his hands. I mean, that's textbook defensive back play. A credit to him. I mean, that's a good play.
It's a big time play.
Yeah, I mean, the ball looked to be, Jefferson not only made a good play, but he was in great coverage. You know, he was step for step with Deion Williams there. So, yeah, you have to, sometimes it's just a good play results in a turnover.
And again, the only number you look at on Montana Tech on paper is that turnover ratio. They have been giving the ball up more than they have taken it away. And we'll see what Rocky does with it here. They put together a nice drive in their opener, but were unable to get points. Handoff is going to go here to the near side, out near the 40, shoved out of bounds at the 41-yard line is Mason Melby. Melby is going to get 6 on the carry before he is shoved out of bounds.
Yeah, it's clear to me Rocky has noticed something in this Montana Tech defense on film, and one of them is they're running the ball. Their outside zone to the boundary side is prevalent in this offense right now, and this is an adjustment that Montana Tech will make. I mean, trust me, the defensive staff at Montana Tech can adjust with the best of them. They'll make this adjustment, but Rocky's running to the boundary.
Second down and 4 is out of the shotgun is Korf. Korf, a long snap count, gets the ball, hands it off to his tailback. Melby finds a seam. Melby's off to the races. 45-40, 35-30, and Melby down to the 20-yard line of Montana Tech. He's tracked down from behind by Reed Siderius, but a big run by Melby. He'll take off for nearly 40, and that will move the chains for the Battling Bears.
If there's any vulnerability of this Montana Tech football team, that's noticeable over the last few weeks is teams have been pretty successful running the ball between the tackles against them, and Rocky's seen that and they're exploiting it a little bit.
So first down and 10 Bears, ball at the Montana Tech 22-yard line. Korf out of the shotgun, two receivers each way. Korf going to keep it himself. He'll go off tackle right, slide to the 20. And that's going to be a gain of 3 as he hits the turf. I was kind of interested to see how he was going to run the football. We haven't seen him run yet. So him coming in here, I was wondering what we were going to see, and he decides to go to the baseball slide. And picks up a couple positive.
He's going to have to read that zone. I mean, if they want to be successful running the football today, four quarters against this defense, he's going to have to be integral in running the football occasionally. He's going to have to pull the ball. Rocky's had good luck with Melby and Sparks there at tailback, but occasionally he's going to have to pull that ball to keep that Montana Tech backside at home.
Second down and a long seven. They're going to run that fly handoff on the near side across the 20, stiff arm out to the 16. As certainly one of those plays you see a lot more at all levels, kind of that jet sweeper fly around the edge. That's Max Gray. Gray comes in their leading receiver. That's his first touch of the football here today. That'll bring up third down and a long three here for the Battling Bears.
Rocky's doing a good job offensively early in this game. They're mixing the ball up, running the football inside, outside, both with outside zone. Of course, the fly sweep a little bit inside with inside zone and counter sweep. And they're doing enough throwing the ball, testing Montana Tech downfield to keep that secondary at home.
Third down and a long three, and they'll run Jenkins out of that wildcat, and he will lose yards again. Not much, but he ran into Connor Wines, and Wines deposited him at the 15-yard line.
Well, Jenkins is a corner or quarterback there, and Wines comes in off the left side and tackles him for a loss. So, question of the day, is that a sack?
No, it was a design run.
Oh, okay.
I hope it is. I've been giving Connor Wines more sacks than he's been getting credit for, so maybe I should keep stats for him. So the kicking unit will come in for a field goal attempt, a 37-yard attempt, 32-yard attempt, and it looks like it pulled right, and it did. So they are off the board again. Rocky knocks on the door. They had a 32-yard attempt from the right hash mark, unable to get it through, and Montana Tech will get the football back. So that sudden change defense stands strong for Montana Tech.
Get the words right out of my mouth. I was going to mention that. They gave up the one.
Welcome back, Montana Tech students and staff from Steeles. Montana Tech is important to Butte and Southwest Montana, and Steeles is proud to support Tech in many ways. Right now, anyone with a current Montana Tech ID will receive a 5% discount on anything in our store, just in time to furnish or upgrade those new apartments or homes. See our selection of home furnishings, mattresses, appliances, and electronics. Welcome back, Montana Tech, from Steeles in Butte and Deer Lodge. Go Diggers!
They're on an island, man.
Yeah, they're
big
out there.
Time.
They put a lot of pressure on them, and they say, come on, guys, just trust your technique. Give us two and a half seconds to get enough pressure on the quarterback and to drag him down, force a throw away. But, they really do, and it's a huge amount of trust, and it's a very difficult position to play, especially against the talent Rocky's going to put on the field, and there's so many good players out there. But they put the pressure on. I mean, it's just a tough job, and the second somebody complains about it, they say, you think your job's tough? Go line up at left tackle and see how tough that job is.
First down and 10, Fike in the backfield with McQuarrie. Fike will get the carry. Up the middle, he's out to the 25-yard line. So Fike with the carry, that is his second carry of the afternoon. He'll get five on the first. He ran for, I want to say, 127 in that neighborhood the first time these two teams played.
Yeah, Fike's settled in. Oh. He is really settled in. You know, I'm not going to say he looked like he struggled early in the year, but, you know, just looking to find his feet. But I tell you what, he looks really good in this offense. Right?
Second and five, Fike will get the carry again. Tries to bounce it right. He's hit at the line of scrimmage, but gets forward for a gain of two, nearly three.
Rocky.
You know, Fike, the reigning NAIA player of the week offensively, as he ran for nearly 250 in 30 minutes of football a week ago.
Rocky just, you know, when Montana Tech lines up, in the not a bunch set, but something that looks wide receiver screenish, you know, whether it's slip screen or bubble screen. Rocky's just literally sprinting somebody up there to blow it up. Watch number five, I believe that's Dallas Mack. Watch him. He just steps in there and blows it up.
Third down and three, and now we have flags aplenty. And it looks as though we're going to get an offside call here.
You'll see Montana Tech with multiple receivers to the same side against, say, Dallas Mack there trying to blow it up. You'll see them start to layer stuff in that 5 to 15 yard downfield range, and force a cornerback to make a decision there. But you'll see them progress here and really start to layer stuff downfield a little bit.
So let's get this sorted out. Third down and two here for Montana Tech. As they look to change out some personnel, Sean Sullivan will check out of the ball. You know, he'll just go wide. So Sullivan, Deion Williams, and Chris Kelly on the near side. And it looks as though we're going to get a flag down. And we'll see what we get here once again.
You're gonna get
the Rocky sideline is going crazy.
You're going to get Hape and Nate Yount both lunged on the hard count there.
And it's going to go against Rocky.
Ooh, I thought I saw lunging on the left side of the ball. I never saw anything come across that would force that lunge.
Yeah, boy, and that's what I looked up to see the Rocky coaches, and they were just going bonkers, so they were certainly on your side of this. First and 10, Montana Tech. They move the chains via the penalty. Two receivers left. Tight end right, Sean Sullivan in motion, stops behind Chris Kelly. They're going to run a screen out to him. Sullivan across the 35 to the 38-yard line. And that should, or excuse me, he was behind Deion Williams that time. And it goes back to the point you and I have made, you know, going back to the Wildcat year when Montana Tech was without a quarterback. Those receivers from then on have been so good in the blocking game. You know, it just pays dividends every week out on the field. McQuarrie hands it off to Fike. Fike off tackle right. 45 out near midfield as he's hauled down after a gain of 9, and that will move the chains for the Digs.
Jed Fike's going to see some opportunities to run the football, but I doubt they're going to open up like they did last week against Northern. I mean, they're tough yards, and that time he saw daylight. You could see it the second he saw that daylight. He exploded through the hole for first down yardage.
Quickly to the line of scrimmage. They'll run screen out to Deion Williams. He bobbles it for a minute. He's across midfield to the Rocky 48. By the time he got possession of that football, there were a sea of white jerseys there. And that's going to be a pickup of 4. Bring up second down and 6.
You know, getting back to, you know, the great job on the perimeter that this receiver crew does in their not just their zone running attack, but, you know, for slip screens, bubble screens, stuff like that. You know, go back to their position coach, Doug Schliemann. He's done a wonderful job. You know, Doug's a former O-lineman. He knows the importance of blocking.
Three receivers right, play action. They're going to run screen to the right to Chris Kelly. Kelly is hit at the line of scrimmage. That's a nice play on the far side. As coming up and making that play is Kendall Jefferson, the defensive back out of California.
They list.
We've got 2 9s.
Well, that was 5. They list 2 of them. There's Overton and Mack. I'm assuming it's Mack, the older of the two, that's playing that outside backer, but he's the one they're sending up to blow up that bubble screen stuff. They're sprinting him to the line of scrimmage.
Third down and 6 for Montana Tech. 2 receivers on each side.
I don't have a 2.
And McQuarrie will take it out of the shotgun. Fike in the backfield, ball at the Rocky 48-yard line. Rocky showing blitz. Here it comes. McQuarrie in trouble. Ball comes out to the ground. Montana Tech dives on it, but they're going to lose huge yards, but they do get on the football.
Yeah, Ryder Rice, they moved him from outside to inside that time. He looked like he was bluffing up there on the blitz, but he shot a gap and was in McQuarrie's face so fast. Right up right up the B gap, and he was in McQuarrie's face. Not only made the sack, but he stripped the old sack?
Yep, he pulled her out of there, and Yonk, a heads-up play down in the offensive front to get back and get on that football. And the punting unit is in for Montana Tech. Short kick, ton of air under it, and it's going to go out of bounds around the 45-yard line. And Rocky going to get great field position as the kick went off the right side of the foot. And we're looking at maybe a 15 to 20-yard punt somewhere in that vicinity. So Rocky will take over at their 45.
Golf world, we call that a old.
I call it a nice wedge shot for me, personally.
As long as it's in the air.
As long as it's in the air. I didn't blade it out on a continental. 20 seconds left to play in the opening quarter. We have 7 points on the board. Montana Tech leading 7-0. Here come the Bears in their offensive possession. As Shinola goes in motion out to the left side, long snap count for Korf. Korf drops back, stands, delivers downfield. A gain of 4. And Korf, boy, he got hit hard again, but he stood and delivered that football downfield.
Yeah, Jenkins is really well covered that time. After the adjustment,
at the line of scrimmage, and Zach Morris came up off his hash mark at safety into that alley, and he was, I mean, literally step for step draped on Jenkins, and Korf was able to thread that ball in there, and Jenkins was able to catch it.
It's amazing to me that we have six kids in this family that grew up on a farm, small ranch. We all turned out to be engineers.
My great-grandparents, all of their children attended Tech and graduated with degrees. Montana Tech, it felt more like a family, and they really wanted me to come and be a part of it.
Very rare you'll see a family of six engineers and married to engineers. So there's a bloodline there that's pretty rare.
Montana Tech is my family's solution.
My name is John Wick. I am a graphic designer, as well as a teacher and executive director, and I wear a whole lot of other hats. I basically want to drink coffee and make really cool things. My experience at Tech really gave me the confidence to say, well, I can go out and do that stuff. Montana Tech really legitimized and helped me develop the skills that I didn't even really know that I had. Montana Tech was my solution.
Welcome back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech, Bob Greenfield at Alumni Coliseum. The Battling Bears with the football at the Montana Tech 48-yard line. Third down and three as Drew Korf brings him up. Two receivers on each side of the football, one back at home. Montana Tech presents a four-man defensive front. As Korf looks to the sideline for the play call, Montana Tech's defense will do the same. Just underway here in the second quarter, Montana Tech leading 7-0. Montana Tech shows blitz. They back out. Korf slant route through the middle is caught on their feet across the 40 to the 38-yard line. And there was a little shoving going on downfield. No flags down.
No, they were just Jenkins was just looking to pick up a block of a pursuing Montana Tech coordinator. You don't think Jenkins will load there at tight end and playing a little wildcat quarterback? He turned around and blasted Connor Wines head on head and knocked Wines right on his rear end. I mean, Wines is a load.
Yeah. Can we arrange a smoker with those two? That would be epic. First down and 10.
The old smoker.
Korf, does that age us?
Oh, yeah.
Two receivers on each side. Korf with a fresh set of downs at the Montana Tech 37-yard line. 13:35 left to play in the first half. Hand off to his tailback, bouncing right, and nothing positive there for Jade Olson.
You know, my career smoker record is 2-2.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you get two people not show up, or did
they
you
might get... as well not have. J.P. Gallagher was at Western. He arranged me a couple patty cakes down there. But the old smoker. Thought I could tell smoker stories until the end of the broadcast. That was the greatest event Montana Tech ever put on.
Second down and 10 here for the Bears. Ball at the Montana Tech 37-yard line. Three receivers left, one back at home. And Korf out of the shotgun. The freshman out of Idaho brings man in motion across to Shinola. Shinola stops on the right side about 8 yards off. Play action. Korf drops back. He's flushed to his right. Korf in trouble, looking downfield, airs it up, and throws it more out of bounds than anything to keep that play alive. Nice job by Korf to roll right as he had heavy pressure following him.
Yeah, Montana Tech rushes five. Polly got in there and spooked Korf out of the pocket. And then Chance Hansen was on the chase, took a good angle against Korf. Korf was able to kind of turn the corner and get rid of the football, but Hansen had him angled up to where he couldn't get back to the line of scrimmage, and that's all he needs to do there is pressure him into a throw.
Third down and 10 here for the Battling Bears. Two receivers on each side for Korf. Montana Tech showing blitz. We'll see if they stay in that on third down and 10.
Catch Montana Tech looking showing half field, but at the snap of the football, they're going to be walked up into three deep.
Here comes the blitz. Korf, rifle shot right side, complete first down yardage as he gets it out to Max Gray. Gray, their leading receiver, gets his first catch of the afternoon, and that will move the chains for the Battling Bears. The Bears have run 20 offensive plays for 114 yards, and they're looking at first and 10 from the Montana Tech 23.
A lot of success for this Rocky offense early in this football game, no doubt about it. They've moved the sticks, maintained possession. They haven't scored yet, but you know, the other goal of this offense for Rocky coming in here is keep the ball out of Quinn McQuarrie's hands, and they've done just that
they
so
have.
Far.
Yeah, time of possession would be real interesting here as we take a look. They're bringing a man in motion, then they stop the play. And now we're going to get a timeout. Rocky going to be forced to call a timeout as the play clock got awful low. So Rocky will call their second timeout, and with it, we'll take one as well. Montana Tech leading 7-0. 11:56 left to play here in the first half. We're back after this one-minute break.
Are you nervous?
No, I don't think so. Want to hand me your gum there, Missy?
No.
What do I like about this little kid? There's lots.
We hang out a lot.
Ronald's very outgoing.
My bigs are the best. They're super nice.
We go horseback riding.
She just has a great sense of humor.
I like that she brings out the kid in me. It kind of makes me emotional. Hold on.
It's a lot of fun just being able to go with them.
She just really makes me happy when I'm with her.
Sign up. Do it. It's way fun, and you'll have a friend for life.
Scores of the Class A playoffs in the second quarter. It's the Dillon Beavers 19, Butte Central Maroons 7.
Has dimmed that light quite a bit.
Today, but moving the football.
They'll fake that jet motion. Korf keeps it himself. He's going to cut back across the field and roll down at the 19-yard line, a gain of 5, but there's a flag down, and this is more than likely in that holding territory. So we'll wait for the white hat and the official call here.
Surprised Korf didn't hand the ball that time on the outside zone. It looked like running back, was it Sparks in there? Had a little daylight off the left side here, but he pulled the ball, tried to take it upfield, ended up changing direction. Montana Tech was all over it, but somewhere in that change of direction, they forced Rocky to hold.
So first down and 20 now from the 33-yard line. Jade Olson in at tailback. Looks like we're going to see three receivers. Actually, check that. They'll go four wide with one back at home. Three receivers left, one to the right. Jade Olson in the backfield for Korf.
See if Rocky does a hard count here and see if they can't make Montana Tech hit their hat on coverage.
Korf looking left the whole way. In the pocket, he's in trouble. Korf is hit, and he's going down. The first sack of the afternoon, and Montana Tech will get the sack and a loss of 8.
James Foote put a lot of pressure on him, but ended up sacking him with his back to the quarterback. Just kind of tipped over against him.
Hey, if it works.
Knocked him down, whatever works, right?
So the loss of 8 will bring it back to the 39-yard line. The first sack of the afternoon. And a second down and long here for the Battling Bears. They need to get down to the 13-yard line. One back lined up in the pistol. Twin tight formation. They're going to run max protect here.
Last time they had this situation, they tried to run the back screen.
So second down and long. Handoff going to go to Jade Olson. He bounces off tackle left. He's across the 35, down to the 34. He'll pick up a positive 5, nearly 6, bring up 3rd down and long now for the Bears.
Rocky going to do what they can to at least get into a field goal try range here at the 30. You're looking at about a 50-yarder from here. But, again, last time 3rd and plus 10, they tried to run the deep sideline route down here to Shoffley. We'll see if they don't try something like that to the inside slot, just bending something out, maybe down around the 20-yard line to the wide side.
3rd down and 20. 2 receivers right, 1 back lined up in the pistol, and Korf going to roll out of the pocket right. Hits his man inside the 20, down near the 17. That'll bring up 4th down and 5. And from there, you're probably looking at a 15, 22, 32-yard attempt, 33-yard attempt.
Not tipping their hat. Now they're going to run on the field goal team. It looked like they may want to go for it after missing a field goal attempt earlier in this football game.
So the kicking unit will come in, here for the Battling Bears, and they'll put it down right at the 35-yard line, or the 25, so a 35-yard attempt, 9:27 left to play here in the first half. Montana Tech up 7-0. Snaps low. They're going to run the shovel on the interior. Tried to go for it and fake it, and Montana Tech just destroys it. Jenkins, he got the shovel pass, and he was destroyed, and the turnover will go to Montana Tech.
After a quarter, a little over a quarter of this football game, Montana Tech struggled defensively to stop Rocky. But if there's one component of this Rocky offense that it's clear they're prepared for is Jenkins.
Yeah.
You know, Jenkins hasn't been real effective anywhere. You know, both the Wildcat, they've completed a couple balls to him, but he has been well covered. They're well aware that Rocky's going to utilize Jenkins wherever they can.
So Montana Tech back out offensively. They run 14 offensive plays for 87 yards. Man in motion is Sullivan. First down and 10. Play action. McQuarrie wants to throw downfield. Deion Williams too much in front. That'll fall incomplete at the 35-yard line. Second down and 10.
A couple guys in the route that time trying to get Deion a quick little post corner that time, but Rocky had it bracketed. They had safety over the top, cornerback underneath. It would have took a real thread job from McQuarrie to get that ball in there. He's capable of making the throw, no doubt, but that time just forced a little bit of an overthrow.
Second down and 10, Montana Tech ball at their 20-yard line. 9:12 left to play here in the first half. Frontier Conference action on a Saturday. Out of the shotgun, McQuarrie. Rocky showing blitz. Here they come. McQuarrie, quick hitter to Sean Sullivan. He's out to the 24-yard line. That'll be a short gain. Bring up 3rd down and 6. As a big blitz coming that time as Rocky brought the house.
Yeah, Rocky rushed 6. There's zero-man coverage across the board. And McQuarrie just knew he had Sullivan one-on-one on the inside slot. Took the easy completion. Granted, it wasn't for a first down, but you know, when you blitz and make a completion like that against that blitz, it really gets that defense's attention.
3rd down and 6. Trips receivers right. Looks like a mix-up in coverage. McQuarrie dropping back. Rifle shot to the sidelines, and Sean Sullivan out near the 35, but a flag down in the center of the field. As it's 1st down yardage, but this more than likely coming back as a flag down in the center of the field, and it looks like we might see a hold against the Montana Tech offensive front.
Officials looking for a number to call it, but right in that area holding.
It looked like Ryder Rice was coming once again up the middle, the young man out of Savage.
So
a chop block, okay. We haven't seen that call very much. I think second time so far this year.
And again, that chop block, if it's called, it usually means a defender is engaged with an offensive player and another guy chops. I mean, you can chop block in college football, but they take care of somebody that's engaged with one so they're not getting chopped by another while they're engaged head-to-head combat, so to speak. And so a lot of times you'll see you get a running back maybe chipping on a defensive end. You'll see offensive tackle pass set on him, engage with him, and then a running back will go in and chop.
3rd down and 18 here for Montana Tech after the penalty. 4 receivers, 1 back. Blitz is coming. McQuarrie in the pocket, looking to the right side. Goes up to Deion across the 30. Ball comes out, goes to the ground. Rocky's going to get it. There's nothing but white shirts around. They'll say incomplete. They say Deion never had possession of the football. And instead of a fumble, it will be an incomplete pass. And if you're Montana Tech, that's a very lucky break as Deion turned upfield. And from here, it never really looked like he had possession. And then the ball was stripped out before he was able to really kind of corral it.
It was was a clean catch to the point where he reached out to catch it, but as he caught it and brought it into Tuckett, Rocky got in there and got their hands between the ball and his chest and were able to knock it away.
So the punting unit is in here for Montana Tech, 2 yards deep. Stand, deliver, heavy pressure, great spiral, but of course it's whistled dead. Flag down and back, 8:04 left to play here in the first half. As a well-kicked football that time by Derek Holt. And we'll see what we get. Illegal substitution on the defense, so a 5-yard penalty will bring her up across the 15 out near the 18-yard line. 8:04 left to play here in the first half. Montana Tech has run 16 offensive plays for 90 yards. Rocky up near 150 yards so far here in the first half. But the Digs lead on the scoreboard. They're up 7-0 here in this first half of play.
A pretty tough road for Montana Tech offensively after that first series. Their first series so far in this game. You know, your hats off to the Rocky staff. Had a good plan coming into this game.
Good snap back to Holt. Wobbly kick. Bounces at the Rocky 45. Takes a Rocky bounce out near midfield and down at the 48-yard line. So Montana Tech will down it at the Rocky 48-yard line. Is stepping up and putting that one down is Tucker Ralphie. And we have a timeout on the field. 7:49 left to play here in this first half. Montana Tech leading 7-0 over the Battling Bears of Rocky Mountain College. We'll take a break, and Rocky will get the football back after this. Made it a very interesting football game late. Rocky, of course, had Southern on the ropes and honestly should have won that football game out to Ashland. First down and 10 for the Bears. Ball at their 48-yard line. Korff out of the shotgun will hand it off to the right side. Sam Sparks turns the corner, vaults over the 50, out to the 40-yard line of Tech. That's a gain of 13 as Sam Sparks goes through the air, gets first down yardage over the top.
The old pride of Bayside High, Zach Morris came up to make the tackle and tried to go low on Sparks. Sparks sniffed it out and jumped right over the top of him.
Fresh set of downs here for the Bears. Boy, the Bears have had a really nice year under head coach Petrino this year. Like I say, they've had a lot of opportunities against some of the top talent in the nation. And like I say, they honestly should have beat Southern in Ashland.
Clearly making improvements over there.
Very much so.
There's no doubt about it. You can see steady improvement both in scheme and talent.
First and 10, man in motion, handoff going to go out on the right side, turning it up is Melby. Melby puts the head down and is met hard after a gain of 3.
Great hit over there, coming up and making the stop for Montana Tech. Melby lowered his head, tried to run right over the top of Jacob Clark, and Clark just smashed it.
That was a big-time hit. Clark, sophomore out of Billings Senior.
I can only assume Melby's a city name.
Melby is from Baker.
Oh, Baker. Yeah, I knew it was Eastern Montana. Dude, a whole tough Melby just reeks of toughness. There's a ton of really tough Melbys came out of Sydney.
Second and 7. 3 receivers left, 1 to the right. And a pass out to the right side. They hit their big tight end for a positive gain. He'll get near first down yardage. That's Darnell Jenkins with the catch. Jenkins pick up 6. That'll bring up 3rd down and 1 here for the Battling Bears.
Hey, Andre Brown is strong. They list him 5'10", 180 pounds there at the left corner for Montana Tech. Numerous times this year we've seen him just grab guys that were literally twice his size and just throw them to the ground. He came up and stood up 6'5", 250-pound Jenkins that time, and, I mean, didn't give an inch. It's pretty impressive.
Third down and one. They lined up in the pistol. Handoff to Melby. Straight ahead across the 30, piled down to the 27. First down yardage for Melby. So, again, the Bears have done a nice job moving the ball between the 20s. As they start approaching the 20-yard line here, we'll see how that changes.
This defensive front is without the services of Levi Dawes today. I saw him in street clothes to start the game. I don't know what the injury is, but he is in not in football uniform today. So we'll see if any other young bodies play that defensive front. Yeah, I always like Dawes. I mean, he's never been a standout defensive lineman, but he's really filled the gaps, rested starters. He's really, really good against the run. And they're going to miss his services if Rocky keeps trying to run the football today.
5:20 left to play here in the first half. They'll run jet sweep out of the right side. Turning it upfield is going to be Kraft. Kraft is near first down yardage, and he should have it as he's down near the 16-yard line. So Josh Kraft, the sophomore out of Idaho, will turn it upfield on the jet sweep, and that will be a gain of 11 and move the chains for the Bears again. So the Bears continue to pound it on the ground. They have run 29 offensive plays for 160 yards. The bulk of it is on the ground right now, already over 100 yards rushing.
I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I'm really looking forward to the second half to see what adjustments Montana Tech makes defensively to what they've seen so far in this game from the offense of Rocky. Because, Rocky's clear, they're clearly prepared coming into this game, no doubt about it. They're executing well. They haven't scored, but they've moved the football.
Drew Korff out of the shotgun, one receiver each way. Snap is low. Korff digs it out, throws it up in the air, and tipped incomplete near the one-yard line as he was looking for Overton. Lucas Overton, the intended target, one-on-one out there in coverage. It looked like Siderius.
Just trying a little back shoulder fade almost there to Overton, but Siderius wasn't fooled. He was in great position, and he was up through the receiver's hands, make sure he didn't pick that ball away.
They list Overton at 6'1", and Siderius looks like he has a lot more than 2 inches on him, doesn't it?
Yeah.
4:35 left to play in the first half. Out of the shotgun is Korff. Now we've got a flag and multiple flags. And they'll come in and bring it into the white hat here. 7-0, Montana Tech with the lead. Frontier Conference action. So a sideline warning against the Bears.
So what's the sideline? Is that
somebody get out of the box?
Oh yeah, it could be. It could be. I didn't look, but there might have been somebody out there complaining for pass interference, maybe on the previous play too.
Possibly. Yep. Possibly.
And it clearly wasn't pass interference. It was really, really well defended.
4:35 left to play here in the first half. Montana Tech leads 7-0. We've had a chess match here in the first half, but Rocky certainly on paper stacking up some yards. They've run 31 offensive plays for 170 yards. Right now, Melby has 7 carries for 69, averaging almost 10 a carry. Sam Sparks, 3 carries for 22. Josh Kraft, 1 for 11. Through the air, Drew Korff is 7 of 12 for 66 yards for the Battling Bears. On the other side for Montana Tech, 17 offensive plays for 90 yards. Jed Fike, 4 carries for 18 is all thus far. McQuarrie through the air is 8 of 12 for 89 yards. Here's the big one that jumps out. Rocky with 11 first downs. Montana Tech only 5 first downs so far here with 4 minutes left in the first half.
Last week at this point in the game, Montana Tech over Northern was 66-0.
Yep.
And now we got a 7-0 ball game.
We don't know what to do with ourselves. Second down and 10 here for the Battling Bears. Korff out of the shotgun. 3 wide lefts. Jenkins by himself on the right. As Korff looking to Jenkins the whole way. Jenkins lost his feet. Korff forced to go forward, and he'll get sacked. He'll lose maybe a yard. He wanted to rifle it to Jenkins, and Jenkins lost his cleats and went to the ground, and Korff just didn't know what to do with it.
Tucker Ryle getting off his hash, helping Andre Brown to the boundary side. They tried to stuff the ball in that time to Jenkins, but Ralph got off his hash and bracketed Jenkins. Korff saw that and tried to go to his secondary read. By then he was under pressure, tried to get away, and a good rally from that defensive line to sack him short of the line of scrimmage.
Third down and 11, Korff drops back, rifle shot through the middle, pass complete down near the 10. That's going to bring up fourth down as he gets it off to Overton. Fourth down and 4 here for the Bears. Ball right at the 10-yard line.
And Rocky's got to kick the field goal here. I know they may be thinking, but Okay, you've got one missed field goal. You tried a fake field goal. You've done too much offensively if you're Rocky Mountain College today to come away from here without points. You've got, certainly, I mean, there's going to be those people out there saying 4th and 3, been successful on offense, go for it down here. You've got to come away from point with points.
27-yard attempt from the right hash mark, a left-footed kicker. Ball spotted right at the 17-yard line, and we're going to get a flag down. Montana Tech came across and made contact, but were they drawn across is going to be the question. The officials will chat it over. If Montana Tech came across, that's a fresh set of downs for the Bears.
I think you got movement.
And it's going to go against Rocky.
You got movement. It was either 76 or 78. Whoever got steamrolled here, 72, flinched. And Tyler Sanders let the whole crowd know he flinched.
3:17 left to play here in the first half.
Pretty lucky not to get away or, you know, come away with like an unnecessary roughness. He saw the flinch and Sanders just ran right over the top of it.
So it comes back to the 22-yard line. So a 32-yard attempt, right hash mark. 3:05 left to play in the first half. Snap and hold are good. The kick is up, plenty of leg, and he gets it through. So Rocky gets on the board as Montana Tech leads 7-3 over the Battling Bears of Rocky Mountain College. KBOW Butte, 2:59 left in the first half. The Digs offense will get it back after this one-minute break.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stella Kaposha. I'm with the Department of Biology at Montana Tech. One of the reasons that I love Montana Tech is that it's a small school in the heart of the Rocky Mountains. We get the opportunity to give our students individual attention. We've got Yellowstone as a field lab right in our backyard. When our students leave our department, they're field ready, and the employers are excited about having our students hit the ground running. Montana Tech is my solution.
When Montana Tech was being formed, there was this huge need for engineering in the mines in particular. And in 1904, we had our first 10 graduates. And this spring, I'm going to have the opportunity to shake hands of over 500 extraordinary graduates whose lives have been changed because of Montana Tech. That problem-solving capability has expanded to include energy, ecology and restoration, business land management, trades and technical, nursing and health programs. Whatever the problem is, Montana Tech is the solution.
Talked about the special teams for Rocky. Might see some razzle-dazzle out of them. We certainly have so far today. They're going to try and kick it into the no-man's land around the 25. Upback fields it, and he'll bring it across the 30 to the 35. So Montana Tech will start things off at the 35-yard line with the return. Will Wyatt, who had a good ball game a week ago. He came in as a redshirt freshman, ran the football at that tailback position last week. I haven't had to use a roster so much as I did last week. And I'm telling you, some of these guys that are coming up are going to make some big waves for Montana Tech in the years to come.
Yeah, a lot of guys got their first college touchdowns. A lot of them got their first college action. A couple of them found the end zone. Will Wyatt, of course, finding the end zone in that football game. And they're at the up back doing a nice job of fielding that fluttering kick and getting about 10 yards of return on it.
Three receivers, one back for McQuarrie. Three-step drop, looking left. He's going to hit it to his back, actually his tight end. Osborne goes up. He's across the 45. First down yardage for Osborne.
It looks like he's on a trampoline. He is such a big human,
yeah.
Osborne is. I mean, he's just, not that he's overly big, but just thick. And when he leaves the ground, the guy's got a great vertical. We've seen him go up and catch balls in traffic. And that time, it looks like he's jumping off a trampoline.
They come in with a quick offense. Spike will get the carry. He fights for two. And, boy, he looked like he was going to lose a yard or two and is actually able to turn it positive. That'll bring up second down and 8. As you mentioned, we haven't seen much running room for Jed Fike here today. He ran for over 120 last time these two teams played the bulk of it in the second half. They'll drop it off. Big hit. Chris Kelly holds on to it. 45 to the 41. First down yardage for Chris Kelly.
Montana Tech receiving corps, you know, and they're starting to settle in. What they're going to have to realize is they're going to get hit. But remember, you're big, you're strong, stay on your feet and fight for yards, and that's what Chris Kelly did.
They're going into the real hurry up here. McQuarrie rifles it downfield to Kelly at the 30-yard line. Chris Kelly holds onto it. That'll be a gain of 11. So we're seeing that real hurry-up offense out of Montana Tech. We've seen it against Carroll twice. We've seen it against Northern once. And now they are back after it. This thing is pedal to the floor. Two receivers on each side. McQuarrie looking right, checks it off. Across the middle, hits Chris Kelly again. And it's interesting, when they go into this real fast offense,
Chris Kelly seems to be the guy that ends up with the football, meaning one, is he a great route runner? Does he get himself open? How does that work?
He works great in zone coverage. He knows how to step away from defenders, working gaps, present himself in open windows for his quarterback, and he's so sure-handed that McQuarrie never doubts him.
Second down and four, four receivers, one back at home. Handoff is going to go to Fike. Fike, not much there. And that's something you're going to – I mean, this Rocky defensive front, it doesn't matter who's been the head coach down. Their front especially has always been incredibly sound. You know, you go back to the years of Erlacher down there, and they are just incredibly good in that front seven and especially the front three or four.
Always put 11 guys on the field that will come up and just belt you right in the mouth. And they've done a nice job of moving Raider Rice around in that defense. That time he was in on the tackle, you know, right there by the center. It was just an inside give up the middle, but Rice has done a nice job of moving up, beating defenders, and making tackles.
Rocky stacks up the defensive front. Fike gets the carry. He's across the 20-yard line. First down yardage by the spot. So with 31 seconds left to play in the first half, Montana Tech leading 7-3. The handoff to Jed Fike, he'll get first down yardage. They'll set the football and start the clock.
He meets Denton Weatherall, 206-1, 270-pound defensive tackle. Weatherall's had a nice series so far, you know, on this two-minute series, but Fike had to carry Weatherall for about 2 yards there.
And it looks like Coach Morella's going to try and get time added to the clock. Yep, they're going to add some time on the clock. As he called that timeout, he was really riding the official as the clock started, so I think he's trying to fight for more time, honestly.
Where did our 2 minutes go?
They're flying. This drill for Montana Tech as it got started, and the clock burning away. Montana Tech leading 7-3, looking to add some points here.
As I sit here, I have to actually get out of my chair and lean forward to find the clock, so I really haven't been paying attention to it. I knew we were a 2 minute offense and had to get the ball, but as fast as Montana Tech was moving downfield, I still assumed there was a minute and a half left in the football game.
So as the teams huddle up here, Montana Tech has one timeout remaining, or Battling Bear has one timeout remaining as well. And we'll see what they bring out here. First and 10, just inside the 20-yard line for Montana Tech. If you're the Digs, you have 26 seconds left. You have one timeout, and the clock will stop if you move the chains.
Probably won't see Fike carry the ball, of course, here, but you may see him out of the backfield. Montana Tech's run some nice stuff with him, either on the give fake up the sideline or down the middle of the football field. They've got packages with Fike getting out of the backfield, and, of course, they're dangerous one-on-one with Deion Williams.
Split backs, three receivers, both stay to block, and McQuarrie in trouble, throws it downfield, incomplete. Really he was looking for Feist Hamill. And it, like I say, more of a throwaway than anything. That pocket started to collapse. He got rid of the football, stops the clock, second and 10 with 20 seconds left to play first half.
Really good throwaway. A little bit of pressure that time. McQuarrie got stepped up, didn't like what he saw at first, and thought, yeah, maybe I can get away and run for a first down here. And last second knew he was going to get tackled and got that ball thrown away. Gave his receiver that time, Feist Hamill, a little bit of a chance, but more of a throwaway than anything.
Trips receivers right, one to the left, one back at home here for McQuarrie. Looks right the whole way. Pocket collapses again. He steps up. Now he loose to the right side. Airs it up. Base of the end zone, and it's picked off. Intercepted in the end zone by the Battling Bears. And they're going to get the pick, and taking that one down for the Bears is going to be Keenan Fagan. Fagan will get the interception with 10 seconds left to play here in the first half.
Good physical play by Fagan there in the end zone. He's one-on-one with Deion Williams, and we've seen Williams get body position on more of those than he doesn't. But, Fagan just, he didn't allow himself to get bullied in the end zone. Stepped in front of that, made the catch. You know, it looked like he might be lacking a little bit of possession going out of the end zone, but it looked like, with 1 foot in, he was still able to control that football, tip over, and secure the turnover.
And the ball floated into the end zone. It didn't have a ton of zip on it, and that really allowed Fagan to get good body position and get that ball before he was able to get out of bounds. So a turnover will go to the Bears. 10 seconds left to play in the first half. Montana Tech leading 7-3. The Bears do have one timeout. Montana Tech has two safeties over 20 yards off the line of scrimmage. They'll hand it off to the right side, as Sparks down the right sideline, shoved out of bounds at the 23. 4.8 seconds left here in the first half.
You forget how fast inside areas is. They're working up from safety. Sparks can pick him up and put him down. No doubt about it. Quick dive. Inside areas ran him down and just gave him a little love tap as he hit the sideline. Sparks did about four somersaults over there. Those are the best. Those are the best when you get somebody's momentum going out of bounds and you just nudge them a little before you just cause a huge wreck.
Second down at 7 here for the Bears. 7-3 our score here as we get ready for halftime. Sparks cuts it back, counter the left side, across the 30, 35, out to the 38. And that's going to do it for the first half. We have 30 minutes of football in the books and only 10 points on the board. It's like a real football score. Montana Tech leads 7-3 over the Battling Bears of Rocky Mountain College. Frontier Conference action here on KBOW Butte. We'll take a break. We'll come back, give you the numbers, talk about the first half and more after this two-minute timeout.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stella Kaposha. I'm with the Department of Biology at Montana Tech. One of the reasons that I love Montana Tech is that it's a small school in the heart of the Rocky Mountains. We get the opportunity to give our students individual attention. We've got Yellowstone as a field lab right in our backyard. When our students leave our department, they're field ready, and the employers are excited about having our students hit the ground running. Montana Tech is my solution.
When Montana Tech was being formed, there was this huge need for engineering in the mines in particular. And in 1904, we had our first 10 graduates. And this spring, I'm going to have the opportunity to shake hands of over 500 extraordinary graduates whose lives have been changed because of Montana Tech. That problem-solving capability has expanded to include energy, ecology and restoration, business land management, trades and technical, nursing and health programs. Whatever the problem is, Montana Tech is the solution.
Originally from Kalispell, Morgan also volunteered abroad. In Peru, Morgan partnered with St. James Hospital and local Peruvian churches to bring medical supplies to Lima, that nation's capital. The group provided lots of services to folks in need, including blood pressure readings, dental help, foot washing, and basic checkups. Thank you for all of your hard work, Morgan. Please join us in congratulating this week's Volunteer of the Game. And with Morgan today's Montana Tech Chancellor Don Blackinter and Director of Athletics Matt Steppen, Montana Tech staff members Teresa Rader and Amy Verlanek. Let's have a big round of applause for Morgan, ladies and gentlemen. Also, fans, back to our punt, pass, and kick competitors. This free contest drew 108 local first through eighth graders from throughout the Butte area. And on the field with us today are the top three finishers in each division, representing girls first and second grade. First place, Hallie Richardson. Second place, Sunny Kohlmeyer. And third place, Lyric Steitzer. Boys first and second. First place, Cody Kirsten. Second place, Cohen Steitzer. Third place, Ravelis McEwen. Girls, third and fourth place. First place, Charlie Greiner.
on a copper mining scholarship to attend a university and get a degree in nursing. She was the first inside of her family, either side, to even think about going to college. So Bev McClafferty, she was a first. She allows Joe McClafferty to be a second. Now Joe's kids can be thirds. My grandkids can be fourths. And that's what really makes a community survive. The great thing about the Butte Initiative is that we've got this incredible institution that's right here. We've got one of the best learning institutions in the country, right in the town of Butte. We have the programming that's available to identify the students in need. We have the ability to retain them when they come to school, because most likely if you're a first generation student, you haven't been taught how to really go to college.
There's a lot of students in Butte that have a need to find a pathway to a world-class university, which is in our backyard. We have the opportunity to change their futures with an education from Montana Tech.
I do want to be the first to go to college because not many of my relatives have been to college.
That conversation needs to start younger and younger and younger. We should be talking about college in second grade. What do you want to be when you grow up? It should be, I'm going to be a college graduate so I can make a difference in my community.
The average Butte student is the perfect fit for Montana Tech. They're raised in families with strong work ethics, and they don't have a lot of means to come here.
I was the first one in my family to ever attend college, let alone graduate, and certainly needed some help in finding a way to go to college financially and literally. From that perspective, this program offers students in Butte a tremendous, tremendous opportunity to take advantage of a financial support system as well as just a mechanical system to get you enrolled and to get you on a path to success.
And this is really bringing about a culture of change for Butte.
Very, very important part of what we do in our community is to show that we're all in this together. We need very, very good role models, and the students and staff at Montana Tech are those role models that we're looking for.
I think that Montana Tech is extremely relevant to the future of Butte. I think that as Montana Tech grows, so will Butte. I think that as a cultural center, as a center of education, it plays a vital role in the future of Butte.
The impact is incredible. That investment enables that student to graduate and go on to solve incredible problems, and that person gives back to us later twofold.
They're recruited here, they're retained here, they graduate here, they go on to do extraordinary things. They go on to live lives they never thought they could live.
I walked out of Montana Tech with a degree in my hand and no debt. That's a wonderful start for a young person.
So when you talk about ordinary to extraordinary, helping somebody financially to be able to better themselves is a key component of that.
So the first generation kid in Butte, Montana right now is thinking, I'd love to go to college, but how am I going to pay for it? The Butte Initiative is going to allow them to pay for it. What we need from our community right now is a level of advocacy, awareness, and financial support.
It's good to have dreams because someday, if you really believe in your dreams, you can make your dreams come true.
You should donate to the Butte Initiative because you believe in giving back, because you believe that a scholarship matters, that you believe that a student who has no academic support within their family structure can make it and can be successful, and that you believe that what you do in giving back matters.
Being the first can transform our community. I've seen it transform my life. I've seen it be a generational transformation for the McClafferty family. I've seen it be a generational transformation for my wife's family, the Cassidy family. Our grandparents came here as immigrant minors. They wanted their kids to get educated. They didn't have the financial means. Now, there's no excuse. We can get the Butte Initiative. We can get funds raised for this. We can allow for students to have an opportunity. We're really going to have to band together as a complete village of Butte to pull this thing off.
It's important for people who are thinking about giving to this initiative to realize that a gift at any level, participation at any point in this process is important. It doesn't have to be a large gift to make a difference. As you build an endowment, you create a large sum of money that will later spin off returns for future students. So as you think about giving, recognize that any gift is important, and I encourage you to give to this initiative.
about 4, maybe 5 yards deep. They'll take a knee, and Rocky will start things off with the touchback. So the Battling Bears offense will come back out. Once again, they ran 37 offensive plays for 202 yards of total offense in the first half, most of it coming on the ground, 24 carries, 129 yards. And we'll see if they change up anything on the ground here in this second half.
That's a difficulty if you're Rocky Mountain. I mean, you had a lot of success doing whatever you wanted to do in the first half. Yep. You didn't get the points to show for it, but you had a lot of success. So you don't necessarily go in and make a lot of changes, whereas the defense feel a little exploited. You go in there, and boy, you're going through grease pan after grease pan trying to make the adjustments you need to be successful in the second half.
Two receivers right, one of the lefts, one back at home here for Korf. Korf will hand it off. And they'll try and stretch the edge, and it's going nowhere. Ball out to the 26-yard line, as with the carry is going to be Jade Olson.
Outside zone to start the second half, the same way they started the football game. Had success early, but that time, multiple defenders there for the outside zone. You saw Brock Pauley get up in the backfield. But more importantly, you saw real support out of Jalen Johnson here at cornerback. And we'll see if Rocky doesn't maybe try a little play action. I see they're bringing Jenkins out here one-on-one.
Yep.
Versus Jalen Johnson.
Jenkins alone on the left, trips receivers to the right, one back at home for Korf, second down and 9. Looking to the single side, Jenkins gets the carry. He's out across the 30. He's hit multiple times, still on his feet. They whistle it dead, a gain of 5.
Good composure that time by Nick Amastoy, running out from middle linebacker. Jalen Johnson has Jenkins wrapped up. And just as the whistle was blowing, Amastoy was coming out for the dream shot. You know, that's a middle linebacker's
yep.
dream shot to pick off somebody as they're being tackled. And
he pulled the reins
and was able to slow down.
One receiver each way, one tight end on each side of the formation. Montana Tech presents a 5-man front, and now the linebackers creep up as well. They're showing they're going to bring the house. We'll see if they stay there. First possession of the second half. And Korf changes the play. Once again, tight end on each side. One back at home. Korf gets the snap, looking left the whole way. He wants the deep ball one-on-one downfield and caught at the Montana Tech 38-yard line, but the official threw his hat. The official threw the hat that he got out of bounds.
Yeah.
His hat is off.
That's Overton. It was a nice catch. It was really good coverage. A lot of contact down there by both players, Jalen Johnson and Overton. But the hat went down. That means Overton was on the sideline, so then does it become a discussion whether he was pushed out or ran out?
It is, so he got out and was able to reestablish himself in the field of play, and that is a first down of the Montana Tech 34-yard line.
You could almost smell that coming, and I think that was all stemming off the early support from cornerback on the outside zone. Johnson was in the backfield in a hurry, and that tells you as an offensive coordinator, that guy wants to make tackles in our backfield. Let's see if he can defend receivers downfield.
First down and 10 here for the Battling Bears. Three receivers, one left, two to the right. And Korf going to roll out of the pocket to his right. Airs it up, pass complete, spin move at the 25, down inside the 20, out of bounds at the 18-yard line. First down yardage as the pass complete on that far side. And it looked like with the reception out there, and it looks like with the catch is going to be Max Gray. That's his second catch of the afternoon. Excuse me. Bring up first and 10 right at the 20-yard line.
Andre Brown going to get a breather here and get a Coach Burrell wanted to talk to him on the sidelines, so they ran Devonnie Brewer out there to play left cornerback. He's lined up over Overton on the right side.
First possession of the second half. Two receivers on the lefts. Korf gets the handoff. He'll go out to the right side, and nothing there. Great read. Nice tackle. Jade Olson is going to lose half a yard.
Yeah, that's Amastoy working up from inside backer. Montana Tech bluff and blitz, but Amastoy got layered enough where he could kind of overstep anybody, any offensive lineman trying to get to the second level, work down the line of scrimmage, then shot his guns there right at the numbers on the 20-yard line and drug Olson down.
Rockies run 40 offensive plays for 244 yards, second down and 11. Ball at the 21-yard line. As Korf, the freshman quarterback out of Idaho, two receivers left, one on the right. Korf drops back, rifle shot here on the near side, pass complete. Stiff arm, and they're going to whistle it dead at the 15-yard line. As with the catch is going to be Taylor Schwartz.
I love that power play, even though the whistle's blown. Nobody wants to give an inch that time after the whistle. Jalen Johnson holding on to his jersey, saying, I'm still not going to let you go until you give up.
So third down and 5 here for the Bears. Again, Rocky has been inside the 20 several times today, but only one field goal to show for it.
It's a small thing, but it's an important thing. One thing Montana Tech, they're bringing pressure, and Rocky's doing a nice job of picking up the pressure packages. They've got to get their hands up. Watch them coming on the outside. David blitzes here. Connor Wines, Brock Pauly, get your hands up. You're not getting to the quarterback. They've got to make life more miserable for Court.
Third and five. Melby is hammered at the 13-yard line. He'll gain a yard. That'll bring up fourth down and three, and the kicking unit will come in.
Yeah, it's shaping into that kind of game where, no discussion here on the sideline. Yep. Fourth and three, I mean, a lot of teams might think go for it, but Rocky knows, hey, there's only 10 points on the board so far here in this game. Every point is a premium. Go out and get the 3 points and make this a less than a field goal game.
A 30-yard attempt just inside the left hash mark. Again, no wind at all. It's absolutely gorgeous. Rocky only had 10 on the field. And they had to bring in an extra here.
I don't know why they stopped them.
Yeah, we got a whistle. So a 30-yard attempt just inside the left hash mark. And now we're getting whistles aplenty as the play clock hit zero.
Of course, Rocky might have thought when they blew the whistle, they didn't stop the play clock. Rocky might have thought they would stop the play clock there, and I don't know why they wouldn't.
Yeah.
But they didn't.
So delay a game against the Battling Bears. What was a 30-yard attempt now will come back and be a 35-yard attempt.
Kind of an officiating snafu, I would think, a little bit.
Yeah, that's an area I certainly don't know. That whistle blows. You think the play clock would stop anyway. 35-yard attempt awaiting the snap. Snap and hold are good. The kick is up. Tunnel leg, and it looks good, and it is. So we have a one-point football game as Montana Tech up over the Battling Bears 7-6. 10:30 left to play here in this third quarter. With a timeout, we'll take it. And the Digs will get the football after this one-minute break.
We don't believe that you have to be born into extraordinary circumstances to live an extraordinary life. So what we want to do at Montana Tech is we want to put more students on that extraordinary path.
We take our students out of the classroom into the field.
Montana Tech promotes problem solvers, not problem makers.
They're able to adapt to pretty much any situation.
At Montana Tech, our students graduate and they go to work. They live the American dream. By supporting the Montana Tech Foundation, they're helping us put more students on that extraordinary path.
He's a quality coach.
But
he's
a
good person.
Back.
Hey, welcome back here once again. Sorry, we were discussing payroll with the chancellor. It's awful nice when he comes in and talks to us about payroll. You know, he bounces it off us. And obviously, you know, the Montana educational system is in a situation where they're trying to trim some costs. And he came in to ask our opinion. And we appreciate that he trusts us in asking that, Haskett.
We're very pro-employee around here.
10:30 left to play in the third quarter. Montana Tech leads 7-6. Remember, the Digs scored on their opening possession and really have had trouble sustaining drives since then.
The best drive they had was a two-minute drive going into the half that ended in an interception. But other than that, it's been a tough, you know, just a tough day for this Tech offense.
Osborne in motion, twin tight right. Fike gets the handoff. He's going to turn the corner. Fike out near the 30, 35 out near the 40, 45 out of bounds at the 46. Jed Fike is off to the races and a late flag.
So a late hit out of bounds, but that's what I was talking about at halftime. You know, you've kind of got to trust him. You know, he's so good at the jump cut. That's just inside zone off the right side. But he did the whole linebacker. And how many times did we see Nolan Saraceni do that for this Tech offense for the 2 years that he was absolutely stalwart back there? That's just a jump cut. Use your speed, turn the corner, and, he exposed an over-aggressive Rocky defense there.
And so with that run, he basically doubled his output. He had 24 yards in the first half, jumps up over 20 on that carry. And after the penalty, as he was hit going out of bounds, it comes all the way down to the Rocky 40-yard line. First and 10 from the 40, McQuarrie out of the shotgun. Play action, McQuarrie drops, looking to throw. Downfield, complete to Sullivan. Sullivan spins at the 30 to the 29. That's a gain of 11. Sean Sullivan. Boy, he does, you know, if the leadership role at receiver for Sullivan and the ability to catch the football, he had the corner draped all over him and Sullivan able to wrangle that one in and move the chains.
Rocky is solid cornerback. Terrence Williams that time. I mean, that's tough. Sullivan wasn't that open.
Fike with the carry. He's going to bounce it all the way to the edge. Fike across the 25-20, cut back to the 15. He's down to the 14. That's a scenario where it shows Fike's speed, because Fike turned that to the corner, and it looked like there were white jerseys. It looked like there was no way he was going to be able to turn that north, and yet he's able to rush for first down yardage and more.
His block, Deion Williams out here, ended up laying Fagan out on the lead block there. Just sustained, and then pancaked him.
Under center, Fike gets the carry again. He's across the 10, down near the 5. McQuarrie has taken the last two snaps under center, and that's going to be a gain of 8.
It's a small thing, but an important thing. You start showing the ability to jump cut, get outside, turn the corner. Next thing you know, those linebackers, they're on their heels a little bit. You hit them, and they go backward.
And off. Nope, ball goes underneath, down near the 4-yard line, and not much there.
You dropped that snap. Yep. That was a mishandled snap from under center. And McQuarrie, that ball was on the ground. It seemed like eons.
And that's another one of those. Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, but you talk about the idea of going from, you know, the shotgun snap to under center. Tech does not go under center much. And they show that there as that football hits the ground. And now an offensive lineman comes to the sideline for Tech. He tried to get off under his own power and then just falls a couple yards onto the turf. And we'll hope he is going to be all right here. 8:48 left to play here in this third quarter. Montana Tech knocking on the door. They'll have third down and 3 from the 5.
That's Whitley. Was it Whitley that was out there with injury, or was it Hape?
It was Hape. So Whitley out of Skyview, and Hape is back. Hape started today. He was back in, I should say he was dressed last week. He did not play. And, you know, talking to Coach Morrell yesterday as we sat down in his office, he said Hape was back and ready to go. But you just don't know if he's back at game speed yet. You know, he's been out for 4 weeks. And Whitley gets up and walks off to the sideline under his own power.
You know, you learn not to question injuries, how bad someone's actually hurt.
Yeah.
But when an offensive lineman is hurt, you know they're hurt.
It's got to be bad.
They're hurt. They're tough. Oh, I can't even imagine. Mangled fingers, mangled knees, ankles. They just get up and keep grinding. So when you see one down on the football field, I mean, you just got to kind of take a extra second and say, he must really be hurt. Those guys can't come out of the game for anything.
And this unit has been so good this year. I mean, you know, they've worked together. I mean, the bulk of this line has been together for 4 years, and they have just so much experience between the tackles for Montana Tech this year.
In Ape's absence, Grant Benz, the younger brother of Luke Benz, came in. And, you know, started and played really well a few games. So I would assume he will be the first one in, and we'll see how they arrange. I just call him offensive lineman. I know one snaps the football and the other four block.
Former coach, ladies and gentlemen, Ron Haskett.
Hi, guys.
I always remembered how important they were, but I never really did understand what they did besides lean on people.
Jalen Whitley is down getting his left ankle. Looks like they took the tape off and they're going to retape it. So Montana Tech, third down and 3 from the 5 with 8:45 left to play here in this third quarter. Full house backfield. Two backs, I should say. As a Fike, the deep back, it looks like Feisthamel is going to be your blocking back on the left side. And a handoff will go inside and right into the end zone. Touchdown, Jed Fike.
So what Montana Tech wanted to do this series, get Fike involved in the game. They didn't even bat an eye there. 3 yards to go. I was thinking play action pass, even out of the heavy set. But they gave it to him, trusted that offensive front, trusted Osborne up there in the sniffer position, and Fike did the rest.
That's a big-time play by Jed Fike. He gets into the end zone. Touchdown number 17 on the year for that young man, and Montana Tech stretches their lead out 13-6 over the Battlin Bears as they score on their opening possession of the second half. So the kicking unit is in for the PAT. Snap and hold are good. Sullivan puts it down and it gets knocked. No, it's no good. The PAT is no good. So a 7-point lead for the Digs, 13-6 over the Battlin Bears. 8:32 left to play here in the third quarter. Bears will get it back after this 1 minute break.
Thank you.
Back here once again to Alumni Coliseum at Bob Green Field as the Digs put together a nice drive, gets 6 points as the PAT no good. High kickoff, return will start at the 5. 15 out near the 20. 25 cut back near the 30, spinning out to the 32-yard line is going to be Overton. So Lucas Overton with the return, and he'll get about 27 yards on the return.
Good return, a high kick. That usually means it's covered well. And real patient return. Overton, just you know, from the few times he's caught the ball today and a couple of his returns, looks really, really comfortable with the ball.
8:25 left to play here in the third quarter. Rocky thus far, 44 offensive plays, 259 yards. And they're split pretty 50-50 here. They have 134 yards through the air, 125 on the ground. And Korf out of the shotgun. Two receivers on each side, one back. Montana Tech presents a four-man defensive front. Three guys at a 3 points. A linebacker crept up as well. Korf drops back. He's looking for the deep shot one-on-one downfield. Boy, there's a lot of hand-checking going on, and that's going to fall incomplete.
I think you get PI there if that ball's not out of bounds. I mean, clearly it was out past the first 3 feet. I saw the official tugging at his waist, but once he realized how uncatchable that ball was, he ate the PI call.
Yeah, there were those two guys were really going after one another down the sidelines. Brings up second down and 10.
That's Brewer in there still. Andre Brown came off in that previous series and hasn't been back on the field yet. He wasn't hurt, I don't think.
Okay. Second down and 10. Korf will adjust the play out of the shotgun. One receiver on each side. Korf has one back. Montana Tech almost a five-man defensive front. Handoff, they'll bounce it here on the near side and going nowhere with it. Handoff to Sam Sparks, and Sparks is swallowed up behind the line of scrimmage. They'll lose a yard.
First play of the second half, we saw the same thing. Tried to get wide on Jalen Johnson, and he came up and shut it down. Beat his one-on-one block. That was Overton out here trying to stock block him. He beat the block, got into the backfield, and didn't miss in the one-on-one opportunity in the flat. Very, very tough tackle to make.
Third.
Against the tailback. That's a very tough tackle to make.
Third down and 9. The Bears are 7 of 11 on third down so far today. Four receivers, one back at home. Montana Tech showing blitz. And they'll bring 6. Korf stands. He's in trouble. He gets away and he's able to throw the football downfield incomplete. He avoids the sack, gets rid of the football. It falls incomplete. And the punting unit will come in.
Big time heat. Carter Myers got into his face and hips, forced him to step up. And then just as Korf tried to deliver the ball, he was hit again. I didn't get a number, but numerous defenders from Montana Tech in the backfield, in his face, forcing him to be uncomfortable enough to miss on the throw.
Boy, the freshman quarterback, Coach Morell and I were talking about the youth at quarterback in this conference and how good they're going to be for a while. Kick is away. A dandy fair catch called for, brought in at the 22-yard line for the Digs. As Lind will haul it down, and Montana Tech will start at their own 22-yard line. So the Digs left to right on your radio dial, and we'll go ahead and keep it here as we make our way through Frontier Conference action on a Saturday.
I love Butte. It's my hometown. I was born and raised here, and definitely part of my soul is here. At Montana Tech, we receive this world-class education that I don't feel a lot of other students receive, and it's so valuable and it's so affordable, so I think that it's a really big benefit to students that come here.
When I came to Montana Tech, I definitely felt inspired to work harder because you're surrounded by all of these incredibly hardworking people that are goal-oriented and they know exactly what they want to do. I think that just the type of students that get recruited here are your driven, really pretty bright students, and when we all get in a room together, we just vibe off of each other and it makes something really incredible. In preparing for dental school, I feel that I've gotten the best education possible through Montana Tech, and I feel well prepared, and I think that I have my advisors and my professors standing behind me, willing to help me.
Team was going to be able to play in the Boise area when we're down there next week. I'd love to go watch this team play, but it sounds like if they won this past weekend, they're in Coeur d'Alene. First down and 10. McQuarrie's going to roll out of the pocket right, looking downfield, and he's going to throw it up for grabs. LeChance goes up, and it's picked off. as Rocky is going to get their third interception of the afternoon. And that is a big time play and an interception by Fagan.
Yeah, Fagan, I mean, if there's one thing that's clear to me is Rocky's secondary has really good ball skills. Fagan, that's his second interception of the day. Both just good plays on the ball. And then you go to their cornerbacks. Let's see here. We have Kendall Jefferson and Terrence Williams, all with, you know, great, great ball skills. I mean, you just got to be a little more careful if you're McQuarrie. He's trying to get his receiver one-on-one to make a play, but sometimes it's just not worth the risk.
Here comes sudden change defense as Rocky's offense back out on the field. They trail 13-6. Out of the shotgun is going to be Korf. Korf has one back, three receivers. Korf awaiting the snap. He brings man in motion, and they're going to run that jet sweep. Handoff goes up as Shinola tries to turn the corner. He's across the 45 near the 30 or 48-yard line before he is corralled. That's going to be a gain of 6 as Montana Tech gets multiple bodies there, but again, a very nice pickup of 6.
Yeah, that's Shinola jet sweep. He runs really well. He's also getting a lead blocker out there. That time, Melby leading the way. I mean, Melby can, he's a fast running back, good size running back, but really fast, able to stay ahead of Shinola out there and get lead blocking.
Second down and 4. Out of the shotgun is Korf. One receiver on each side, one back at home. Montana Tech showing pressure. Korf with a long snap count again, hands it off to Melby. Melby has running room. He's across midfield. He'll get first down yardage to the Montana Tech 44-yard line. And that's going to be a pickup of 6 and move the chains for the Bears.
Good job on the backside of inside zone by that Rocky front. They kind of washed the left side of Montana Tech's defensive line. Inside zone off the left side. The quick wind back and a lot of daylight that time for, was it Melby?
Yep.
Melby to pick up good yards there.
Boy, he runs hard. I mean, there's no shenanigans. Boy, he gets north-south in a hurry. First down and 10. They come out in the pistol. Melby the deep back. Melby will get the carry. He has a blocker off tackle. He's across the 40 to the Montana Tech 37-yard line. And again, that's a pickup of 7, nearly 8 on first down.
Big the power off the right side and leading the way. Like 72, they don't list 72 on their roster. I can only assume either Jared McCray or Tanner Bloom, both over 270 pounds.
So the Bears look to the sideline for the play call. Clock is running. 5:30 left to play here in this third quarter. Montana Tech up 13-6. It felt like the Digs had a ton of momentum there. And, I'm telling you, the Bears just ripped it away. Second down and 3. Hand off. Play action. Korf looking for the deep ball. He has a man down the seam. It's up, tipped, and incomplete. Good coverage downfield. And that's going to bring up 3rd down and 3 for the Bears.
Yeah, Bonnie Brewer, a little bit of contact as he's going up, but his eyes are at the quarterback. He's going up, has to go up over the top of the defender to get the ball knocked away. A little bit of a, you know, chest to the upper back on the backside that time, but Brewer had his hands free. As an offensive coach or offensive coach, I'd be yelling for pass interference, but a good no call.
3rd down and 3 for the Bears. Ball at the Montana Tech 37. Two receivers left, tight end left, and the tight end goes in motion. That's Jenkins. He goes all the way out wide right. Jenkins one-on-one. Hand off to Melby. Melby is met and destroyed, a loss of 2. Melby is hit in the backfield by Amistoy, and now we have a flag real late to the party.
Yeah, I don't know what that would be. That was just Montana Tech was busy, you know, beating each other's chest, you know, in excitement, but I didn't see any extracurricular activities with anybody in white.
5 minutes left to play. Unsportsmanlike, and that's going to give the Battling Bears a fresh set of downs.
Taunting. I mean, seriously, I mean, they just made a stop on 3rd and 3. I don't know how you can make that call. That defense is excited. It's an emotional game.
So a fresh set of downs here for the Battling Bears. 13-6, Montana Tech with the lead. And a taunting penalty will give the Bears a fresh set of downs at the Montana Tech 23-yard line. 4 receivers, 1 back. Korf out of the shotgun. He goes real long in the snap count again, looking right. Quick out, pass complete inside the 20 to the 18. And they get the pass out on that far sideline as it goes Looks like Lucas Overton with the catch. Matlin Bears closing in on 300 yards of offense on the day. They trail by a touchdown.
My blood's still boiling. I've been unable to.
I can tell.
Add to the conversation here. I just cannot believe that that call gets made. You gotta understand the emotion going on in the field.
Second down and four. Handoff will go to Melby. Melby is hit in the backfield again, and he will get back to the line of scrimmage and no more. Melby wrapped up in the backfield. That's going to bring up third down and four here for the Bears.
We'll see what they try and do here. I would think if Rocky tries to run it, they may want to try a counter sweep, you know, something with some better blocking angles. They've tried to run zone, inside and outside zone on these short yardage situations, and Montana Tech's just getting guys in the backfield on them. See if they can't trap someone on a counter sweep, or they make, you know, try to just,
Wildcat.
Yeah.
They're going to come out the Wildcat. Jenkins is going to take the direct snap. He'll keep it, and he actually hand off to the right side, and they're going to come up short. A yard shy of the marker. They handed it off kind of in a counter motion. All the motion at the offensive front was going left. They handed it back to the right side to Sam Sparks. And, boy, actually the second spot, he will be about a yard shy.
Yeah, they've got a yard to go. Down seven. Now the thinking changes a little bit here.
And the offense is staying out there as of right now. 3:03 left to play in the third quarter. The offense will stay on the field for the Bears. Fourth down and one.
Might just try and draw them off sides here, too.
One receiver on each side. Jenkins on the left, Overton on the right. Handoff will go inside to Melby. First down yardage almost into the end zone as he's hauled down at the 5-yard line, as Melby will bring up first and goal for the Bears at the 5.
They were overloaded to the right side that time and just ran inside zone to the left, to the short side. I mean, that's just guard and tackle left of the center there.
Quick snap as they come up to the line of scrimmage, and Montana Tech's going to get a timeout call. So the Digs will get a timeout, so with it, we'll take one as well. 2:38 left to play here in the third quarter. Montana Tech up 13-6. We're back after a one-minute break.
Welcome back, Montana Tech students and staff from Steeles. Montana Tech is important to Butte and Southwest Montana, and Steeles is proud to support Tech in many ways. Right now, anyone with a current Montana Tech ID will receive a 5% discount on anything in our store, just in time to furnish or upgrade those new apartments or homes. See our selection of home furnishings, mattresses, appliances, and electronics. Welcome back.
Side, and he goes nowhere. Back to the line of scrimmage and no more.
Same thing they ran on the short yardage on the fourth and one, but this time they were overloaded, heavy, Stanford, Michigan, whatever you want to call it. Harbaugh does a ton of it, but overloaded, heavy offensive line to the left side and tried to run inside zone to the short, the kind of the undermanned side. Montana Tech was all over it.
Whoops. Second and goal from the 5, one back, one receiver on each side. As Korf out of the shotgun, Jenkins split all the way up top. They're going to go to him on the slant route, and it's knocked in, and he will pull it in for 6. They rifle it in on the slant route, and Jenkins will get the score. Rocky is within 1.
See that coming from a mile away. You're down there, second and goal inside the 5-yard line. You figure if you're going to take a chance throwing the football, it would be on second down. They ran Jenkins out there one-on-one versus Devonnie Brewer. Just got inside position on him, and then all of a sudden you've got the biggest target on the football field to throw it to.
A chance to tie it up. The kick is up, and we are tied. 13 all with 2 minutes left to play here in the third. Frontier Conference action, KDOW Buttes. We'll take a break. The Digs will get it back after this one-minute timeout.
It's amazing to me that we have 6 kids in this family that grew up on a farm, small ranch. We all turned out to be engineers.
My great-grandparents, all of their children attended Tech and graduated with degrees. Montana Tech, it felt more like a family, and they really wanted me to come and be a part of it.
Very rare you'll see a family of six engineers and married to engineers. So there's a bloodline there that's pretty rare.
Montana Tech is my family's solution.
My name is John Wick. I am a graphic designer as well as a teacher and executive director, and I wear a whole lot of other hats. I basically want to drink coffee and make really cool things. My experience at Tech really gave me the confidence to say, well, I can go out and do that stuff. Montana Tech really legitimized and helped me develop the skills that I didn't even really know that I had. Montana Tech was my solution.
You know, Rocky lines up, they have two rows of players out there. You know, it almost looks like they may be trying an onside kick. But Montana Tech has a lot of starters in there and or like wide receivers. Chris Kelly's on that front line. Montausen's on that front line. Sean Sullivan's on that front line.
Yeah, so, they have to be prepared for anything against this Battling Bears. And like I say, and once those two lines disperse, then the Montana Tech front all backs off and you get your up back set up. So first down and 10, Montana Tech at their 25. Tight end in motion, Osborne stops on the right side, handoff. Nope, Fike does get it. Fike tries to find an opening. He'll lean forward for a gain of one.
That time he tried to get the quick jump cut to the outside. Ryder Rice had the full plane contained.
And Fike is still down on the turf. 1:52 left to play here in the third.
I don't think that's Fike.
Isn't it Kay?
It's an O-lineman.
No, yeah, Fike is up. My apologies, it is an O-lineman down. So our second O-lineman down here for Montana Tech in this football game. 13-13 our score. Rocky has run 58 offensive plays for 302 yards. And again, they're almost split down the line. They have 157 yards on the ground, 145 yards through the air.
Kellen Davis, Trevor Hoff.
Montana Tech has run 33 offensive plays for 194 yards thus far.
It was a lot of pain when he went down, too. And they're
very much so.
They're addressing the left leg and maybe down around the ankle.
Trainers came out quickly. Dr. Jovan and staff are out there. 1:52 left to play here in the third. Frontier Conference action on a Saturday. We did get some score updates here. As we mentioned at the half, Southern was beaten up on Western. And also, it looks as though Eastern Oregon is losing to the College of Idaho right now, 14-3. So C of I up over Eastern Oregon, 14-3. Southern over Western, 28-6 at the half. So injured player coming off the field for Montana Tech.
Yeah, and that's Trevor Hoff. He's walking very gingerly on that left ankle. I would be real surprised if he returned the ball game.
So Hop comes out, second down and 9, one back, four receivers. And the hard count brings his own offensive lineman up. Hop's replacement out there got up, and that will back him up 5. So Kellen Davis was in, and he'll get backed up 5. So second down and 14 here for Montana Tech.
Is that enough when you jump off sides, but when you show what the play is? It's the double whammy.
Trips receivers right, one of the lefts. Fike is in the backfield.
Getting into his pass set.
McQuarrie out of the shotgun. McQuarrie looking across the middle. Slant route, Dion. It's bobbled and falls to the turf, incomplete. Boy, they had an opportunity to pick off the fourth pass of the day for the Bears.
And Dion just tried to hit the skids before the ball got there. You know, he saw enough downfield to where he wanted to catch that ball and change directions. He just hit the brakes a little quick.
That brings up third down and long for Montana Tech. Two receivers on each side. Rocky showing blitz. McQuarrie looks over to the sideline. 1:24 left to play here in the third. The Digs and the Bears tied up 13 apiece. Awaiting the snap. McQuarrie drops back, looking right the whole way. As he let go of it, it's knocked into the air, goes out of bounds, incomplete. As Rocky's pressure got to him, and that one gets knocked into the air, so the punting unit will come in for Montana Tech, and Rocky's offense will get the football back.
Yeah, I don't know if he hit a helmet or his shoulder pads. He's kind of shaking that right wrist, right hand a little bit as he threw that ball. I don't know if somebody swiped that arm or caught a helmet or shoulder pad.
1:18 left to play here in the third. They're going to roll out punt this time. And wobbles out across the 50, out near the 45 of Rocky. So the official come up and mark it out. He'll keep going and go into the 49. So the 49-yard line is where the Battling Bears will get started here with this offensive possession. 58 plays, 302 yards. Mason Melby has 90 on the ground. Drew Korff is 14 of 22 for 145, one touchdown, no interceptions for the Bears.
See McQuarrie down there on the sidelines. He's on the phones with his offense coordinator communicating. What do you see? What do you see from up there? See if they can't get some quick adjustments or make some changes to move the football here the next time they see the ball. Only going to see the ball probably once, or excuse me, two series in the third quarter.
Three receivers, one tight end, and they'll run the other way. As Jade Olson looks to find some running room and nothing there for him, he'll get back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a yard as he is cut down on the far side of the field.
Real good job, Zach Morris, coming up from safety there. Just that's in space. Tough tackle again against a tailback out there in space. But Morris not only has to contain him, keep him from the corner on him, but as he cut upfield, Morris had that helmet across his thighs and was able to just literally drop him in his tracks for a one-yard gain.
Second down and 9 for the Bears. Crowd up and trying to get loud here, as the Bears have controlled the football here throughout this football game. Lead big time in time of possession. Four receivers, Korff downfield, almost intercepted. Justin May had both hands on it and just couldn't bring it into his numbers.
Ball tipped at the line of scrimmage or at the first level. I think Connor Wines might have got a paw on it, and then the ball floated back, and it looked like May just reaching behind him was gonna be able to just stick it with his left hand. Looked like he had it for a second, didn't it? And the ball found the turf.
Third down and 9 for the Bears. Two receivers three receivers left, one to the right. And our big tight end is all by his lonesome up top. That's Jenkins. Korff looking to the left. Pass through the middle, complete near the 40-yard line. That's first down yardage as they go to Shinola.
No, that's what I was pointing at, is they had a safety walked over the top of Jenkins. They had Brewer giving him about a 6-yard cushion. Then they had an alley guy, an outside linebacker, who ended up coming on a blitz. But, you know, at the snap of the football, it looked like they were triple covering Jenkins.
First down and 10, Bears at their 41, or excuse me, rather at the Tech 39.
That's when, as a quarterback, you know one of those guys is going to heat you up.
Yeah. First down and 10, and Rocky has to call. Nope, that's the end of the quarter. I thought Rocky called the timeout. We only have 15 minutes left in this football game. Rocky has really controlled the time of possession. We're tied at 13. We'll go into the fourth quarter. Knotted up, ladies and gentlemen, after this 1-minute break. Montana Tech 39-yard line. According to the official numbers, Rocky has had the ball for 30 minutes, Montana Tech for 14.
That sounds really accurate. It seems like Rocky's had the football all day long. Montana Tech has struggled to maintain drives, but when they do drive, I mean, it's big hurry-up stuff anyway.
Yep. So first down and 10 for the Bears. We're tied up 13 apiece. The Bears with 303 yards of total offense. They'll come out one back, twin tight. And Korff will roll out of the pocket to his right. Pump fake once, now calls for help. Korff gets hit as he lets go of it. as, boy, he gets wrapped up again. I'm telling you, Korf has really showed some poise here today. He's taken some big shots trying to get receivers open.
Yeah, that was just, and it was just rollout pass. They sprinted the corner. They went too tight with two receivers to the wide side of the field. They literally only had two guys in the route. They kept Jenkins at home to the near side tight end to pass protect, try and turn that corner. But a good job, Montana Tech stayed in coverage. And then Zach Morris, the Tech safety, came up and got in Korf's face, forced the throw away.
Second down and 10, four receivers, one back. Korf out of the shotgun. Hard snap, gets it, looks to his right. Now the pocket starts to collapse. He's going to escape left, airs it up downfield, goes to Jenkins, incomplete. That'll bring up third down.
Well, that's a ball Jenkins would like back. He did a rally route for his quarterback. Quarterback was looking to the right, came back to the left. Jenkins changed directions, and Korf just whizzed one right by the big nine on his jersey, and Jenkins couldn't make the catch, but that's certainly a catchable ball.
Third down and 10 for the Bears. Montana Tech can use some momentum here, and a big stop would be a big part of that. One receiver wide left, two to the right, one back at home for Korf. Drew Korf. Montana Tech showing blitz. They bring six. Picked up. Korf airs it out. Pass is batted down.
That's how you break up.
That's a big time.
Yep, that's Devonnie Brewer just one-on-one on that sideline. He's running a sideline route at the sticks. Brewer smells it out, stays in his crouch, breaks out of his back pedal, gets his upfield arm across the defender's body and knocks it away. That's just exactly how you drill it.
That's Monday through Thursday. Big time play for that young man, and the punting unit will come in for the Bears. Again, Montana Tech has nobody back. They are expecting just about everything out of this special teams unit for the Bears. So on fourth and 10, they'll stand and punt end over end. Bounces at the 10, jumps straight in the air, rolls to the 5, and inside the 5, down near the 1. Nice punt down to the 1 as the Bullets get down, keep it in the field of play, and Montana Tech will take over. It looks like just outside the 1-yard line.
Now she's go time. I wouldn't be surprised if Montana Tech comes out in two tights. I don't know if they'll put two backs in the backfield, probably Jet Bike alone in the backfield, maybe too tight, too wide, see if they can't spread this front out, run some inside zone at that front, maybe get a cut back and see if they can. First goal.
We don't believe that you have to be born into extraordinary circumstances to live an extraordinary life. So what we want to do at Montana Tech is we want to put more students on that extraordinary path.
We take our students out of the classroom into the field.
Montana Tech promotes problem solvers, not problem makers.
They're able to adapt to pretty much any situation.
At Montana Tech, our students graduate and they go to work. They live the American dream. By supporting the Montana Tech Foundation, you're helping us put more students on that extraordinary path.
Of Arizona, out of Sholo, Arizona, Sholo High School. He ran the ball really well last week. He's a bigger guy. You know, he comes in at 6'2", 205. And he's just another cog in the machine at running back for Montana Tech.
Yeah, you got to be careful down here if you're Montana Tech. I wouldn't test the wide side of the field against Ryder Rice here. He's just, there you go. Now they're going to run over and double up on him.
Handoff will go on the inside to Fike. Fike tried to move out. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage and no more. Fike taken down right at the 1. He tried to sidestep, and it was a really nice tackle in the open field. Brings up second down and basically 10 for Montana Tech.
And that's Fagan. Two interceptions today, having himself a good ball game. But there's a hole there. I mean, we can see the hole developing from up here, just inside zone, off the left side. But that's one-on-one. You run your safety up there. You got to trust him to make the tackle in the hole. And Fagan did not let that Rocky defense down.
Out of the shotgun, McQuarrie. One back, two receivers, tight end right. McQuarrie rolls right, looking downfield. Sullivan squares out and makes a big catch at the 10-yard line. No, he unable to hold on to it. Incomplete pass, third down and 10, Montana Tech. Boy, it looked like he reached out and snagged it, but he's unable to hold on to it. third down and 10 for the Montana Tech offense.
You know, another thing to consider here, what Montana Tech hasn't done on the zone read offense today is McQuarrie hasn't carried the ball. Rocky knows that. Rocky knows Montana Tech wants to protect their quarterback. They don't want to expose him to getting hit. And he hasn't ran the ball on the inside zone yet today.
Nope.
And Rocky's really keen on Fike.
Third down and 10 out of the shotgun, McQuarrie. McQuarrie, play action, wants to throw it. He has time in the pocket, starts to develop downfield. Big hit. And they're going to say incomplete. No flag as Deion Williams is hit as he goes up for the football. And the punting unit will come in for Tech.
Yeah, I mean, Coach, we've seen some borderline non-calls today, but that time Fagan came up from safety as Deion Williams was waiting for that ball to come in and hit him in the back about an eighth of a second before that ball got there, but it caused the incompletion.
So the punting unit is in at the back of the end zone, and a nice kick away. Nose down over the 50-yard line. The return starts at the 45 of Rocky, across to the Montana Tech 42, and a flag all the way here from this sideline. And we might get a sideline warning, honestly, where this kind of, let's see here for a moment. The official's going to go out and tell the white hat.
Well, I think he might have saw something on the return, either a hold or a block in the back. His eyes were all the way across the field, even though he threw the flag from back here.
He made sure to place it at the 48-yard line. Block in the back against Rocky. So a 10-yard penalty from the spot will be marched off from the Montana Tech 48-yard line. We're tied up 13 apiece. Frontier Conference action on KBOW Butte with a timeout on the field. We'll take one. We're back here to Bob Greenfield after this one-minute break.
Welcome back, Montana Tech students and staff from Steeles. Montana Tech is important to Butte and Southwest Montana, and Steeles is proud to support Tech in many ways. Right now, anyone with a current Montana Tech ID will receive a 5% discount on anything in our store, just in time to furnish or upgrade those new apartments or homes. See our selection of home furnishings, mattresses, appliances, and electronics. Welcome back, Montana Tech, from Steeles in Butte and Deer Lodge. Go Diggers!
Are you nervous?
No, I don't think so.
Want to hand me your gum there, Missy?
No.
What do I like about this little kid? There's lots.
We hang out a lot.
Ronald's very outgoing.
My bigs are the best. They're super nice.
We go horseback riding.
She just has a great sense of humor.
I like that she brings out the kid in me. It kind of makes me emotional. Hold on.
It's a lot of fun just being able to go with them.
She just really makes me happy when I'm with her.
Sign up. Do it. It's way fun, and you'll have a friend for life.
Two receivers left, one to the right, one back at home. Montana Tech with eight in the box. Handoff will go up the middle. And not a whole lot there as the handoff goes to Sam Sparks. Sparks will bounce ahead for a gain of three.
Yeah, a little counter sweep play there to start things off. He had an offset fullback that time and pulled and kicked on the end. Montana Tech defended it pretty well. They've seen a lot of zone, a little bit of counter sweep, a lot of zone today out of this Rocky offense.
Eight carries, 40 yards on the day for Sparks, second down and seven. Three receivers left. Out of the shotgun is Korf. In motion, left to right. One receiver wide right. Korf looking left the whole way. He's going to air it up, almost intercepted.
Another really good break on the ball that time is, that must be... Look, see the second number. Is that Brewer?
It looked
there?
Like Brewer again, yeah. He's sideways to us. Yeah, it is. Brewer just finally turned. It is Brewer out there in coverage.
Really good break on the ball. He wasn't too far from picking that thing off and housing it.
So third down and seven here for the Bears. Boy, as you mentioned, this Tech defense has been on the field a lot, and they have really responded. They're getting tougher and tougher here as this ball game goes on.
Yeah, they're nickeled up now. They got inside areas and two man up the inside slot.
Third down and seven. Korf out of the shotgun. Four-man pressure. Korf across the middle. Pass complete. Still on his feet is Jenkins. Jenkins inside the 40. 35. The pile moves him down to the 33. Jenkins caught that in stride and just pinballed off of people, and he'll move the chains down to the Montana Tech 34-yard line.
Great coverage that time. Jenkins just running the square in, but it's great coverage, but just a big target. Jenkins, I mean, he gets that number exposed to his quarterback, and it's, I mean, it's got to look virtually impossible for Korf back there not to complete the ball.
First and 10 from the Montana Tech 34. 12 minutes left to play here in this football game. One back, three receivers. Tight end right. Play action, Korf going to roll out of the pocket to his right. He's being hounded downfield, complete to the 15. He gets it down into the hands of Max Gray. Gray will pick up his third reception, over 30 yards on the day, and that will move the chains again for the Battling Bears.
Korf's got kind of a funny throwing motion, but he's been really accurate today throwing the ball downfield. I'm talking about stretching it downfield past 10, 15 yards. He's been on target. He's kind of got a goofy motion.
Yeah, it almost feels like the ball stays below the ear hole on his helmet, kind of keeps it almost, not a sidearm sling, but it certainly is, his elbow is cocked pretty hard. First down and 10, four receivers for Korf. Slot right comes in motion. They'll hand it off to the tailback, Sparks, as the pile goes down to the 10, and an offensive lineman gives him an extra shove down to the 8. That thing was stopped initially for a gain of about 2, and then one of the offensive linemen kind of met it at the back of the pile and just gave him a big old shove forward.
Yeah, that was one guy trying to make the tackle, and about 3 others in there poking at that football, trying to dig it out, cause a turnover.
11 minutes left to play in the football game. We're tied up 13 apiece. Rocky, second down and 3. Korf out of the shotgun, Sparks on his right hip. He has a tight end on the right side with a receiver each way. Korf looking left, the solo side. They're going to throw it up into the end zone. Caught, touchdown, Battling Bears. Rocky will grab their first lead of the afternoon.
Last time one-on-one down near the goal line, they went to the slant to Jenkins, and that time they stomped on the slant with, was it Overton?
Yep.
Yeah, Overton, and went to the fade route, and Brewer got himself out of position. We could see him backpedaling, trying to make a play on that ball, but he was out of position.
10:36 left to play here in the football game. Rocky up by 6, 19-13, as the Bears grab their first lead of the day. The PAT is up, and it is good. 20-13, the Bears over the Diggers with 10:36 left in this football game. We'll take a break. Montana Tech will get it back after this one-minute timeout. There. They'll go right out near the 15 line, trying to find somewhere to go and nowhere forward, as the return just shy of the 15-yard line, and that's where Montana Tech's offense will get started. They'll have to try and get some of this momentum back from Rocky, as Rocky really feeding off it right now.
You know, it was Alex Steele getting
a
chance at a return there. Well, it's tough to tell the Montana Tech numbers, and both him and Levi Lyon, neither one of them are real huge guys, and they run alike. Tough to tell the difference.
So first down and 10 for Montana Tech here in this second half. They've run 39 offensive plays, 195 yards. They average 600 yards a game.
Alex Steele's the nephew of my freshman year in college roommate, Kelly Woolley.
Really?
Yeah, I just
found
that
go.
Out last week.
Okay, first down and 10, one back, trips receivers right. Montana Tech gonna run some razzle-dazzle here into the Wildcat, and they'll run away from the three receivers. Trying to turn it upfield, stiff arm, Fike across the 20 to the 21. and no horse collar tackle.
Mike wanted the face mask and the horse collar, but there's your answer to, you know, I mentioned in the previous series, Montana Tech hasn't ran the ball with the quarterback yet today, haven't exposed McQuarrie at all. So that time before the snap, McQuarrie and Fike just switch positions, and they snap it right to Fike for the quarterback sweeper on the left side.
Fike was initially lined up in the slot on the right side. They swap out. Montana Tech four receivers this time. Trips left, one to the right, Fike in the backfield. McQuarrie, play action. They're going to run screen to LaChance. His first touch, LaChance leaps over a guy at the 30, out to the 33-yard line.
What's with all the leaping? That's the third one today we've seen.
Jeez. A lot of Sports Center moments here today as LaChance goes up in the air, and that will move the chains. LaChance stays on the field. Watch out for the deep shot to Chris LaChance. Trips receivers left, one to the right. One back at home. Montana Tech trailing by a touchdown. They look to break it up. McQuarrie stands in the middle, rifle shot downfield, complete to Sullivan out to the 42-yard line. That's a gain of 9.
Rocky's just sitting back in coverage right now, rushing 4, trusting the 4 to put a little pressure on, but most importantly to contain McQuarrie and see if they can't get the stop in coverage. And we've seen a lot of 2 safety luck here by Rocky.
2 receivers on each side for McQuarrie, second down and short. Fike gets the carry, and he'll get hammered in the backfield. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage and nothing more. I was watching the linebackers anticipating screen on the last time they lined up with 3 receivers again, and watching them kind of lance through the 2 receivers trying to get into the backfield.
I'd like to see Montana Tech run maybe inside zone read off the right side and have McQuarrie keep the ball here to the left. I don't know if I'd go to Ryder Rice's side, but I would certainly try the other side here. They're going under
third and
center.
2. Third and 2 under center, twin tight left. Fike will get the carry behind the twin tight. He bounces it out to the midfield. Fike jumps straight ahead. He'll get 8 on the carry, and that'll move the chains for Montana Tech.
Good cut in the backfield. Just zone off the right side. Quick little cut back. He exploded through the hole. Almost kept his balance. Looks like he keeps his balance there. He may score.
They'll stay with twin tight. Osborne blocking. Fike cuts back. He has running room. He's across the 45, down near the 40. Finally down to the 37. That's a gain of 13. And honestly, as Fike turned it upfield, Montana Tech might have got away with a hold on the front of him. I looked up and I thought I saw a handful of jersey.
Well, I was just going to say, Sean Sullivan was downstairs or downfield maintaining a block. But as Fike approached him, he had to sustain a block for a long time. He pulled his hands back. And, you know, almost to say, okay, I was holding, but I'm not anymore. You know,
first
the
down,
ref forgave him.
First down and 10. One back, 3 receivers. McQuarrie rolls out of the pocket left, drops it to the sideline. Sullivan stops at the 33 and goes out of bounds at the 32. It's going to be a gain of 6.
You know what I like about Sullivan? He finds room on that sideline when he's on the sideline that I never see is there.
Yeah.
So you'll see him catch the ball on the sideline. Looks like he's going out of bounds. All of a sudden, there's a change of direction, a spin, a couple more yards. It's kind of funny.
You know what I like about Sullivan? His old man. He's always down here. I envy it. I'm envious of his hair. Trips receivers left. Fike will get the carry up the middle. Bounces it left. He's inside the 30, down to the 26-yard line. That's first down yardage for Jed Fike.
It's important that you end this drive with points on the board, no doubt about it. But just the fact that they moved the chains, ate up some clock, and got their defense some rest, a chance to get coached up, get some rest, get a rinse, kind of absorb the game a little bit before they have to go back out and deal with an offense that's giving them fits all day long.
Montana Tech has been forced to bring in a lot of tight end sets here to adjust for the pressure that Rocky is bringing them. Play action, McQuarrie goes left side. Nice job on the edge, batting that one down as Rocky got a secondary player up there to knock it down. And that looked like Jefferson. Kendall Jefferson, the junior out of California, reached across and swatted it away from Sean Sullivan.
Nice looking cornerback. You know, we saw the play he made on the McQuarrie's first interception of the day, just an athletic high point play in man-to-man coverage, but yeah, real good body control by Jefferson.
Second and 10, under center, McQuarrie hands it off. Fike has a huge gap. He's across the 20, down to the 17, a gain of 9, nearly 10.
He wanted to cut that off the right side and see if he could score, but I think if he could have it back, he would have just lowered his head and made sure he got the first down. They're going to be about a yard short here.
Third down and 1 for Montana Tech. They'll stay in the same set. 2 receivers right. McQuarrie under center. Fike the deep back. McQuarrie hands it off to Fike. Fike skates across the 15. He's down to the 13. First down yardage and a gain of 4.
Now Rocky's starting to feel the pain of a sustained drive. If you look down there, there's a lot of hands on hips in that defensive front. If it was a little chillier out here, you would see massive fog coming from those face masks. They're a little worn out right now, and Rocky doesn't play near as many guys on the defensive side of the ball as Montana Tech does.
Fike over 110 yards on the ground for the day. 6 minutes left to play in the football game. One receiver each way. Out of the shotgun, McQuarrie. Sullivan comes in motion. He'll stop just off the edge. Hand off to Fike. Fike bounces right. Fike has running room at the five. Touchdown, Montana Tech. Jed Fike is in for six. Jed Fike picks up his second rushing touchdown of the afternoon. That's his 18th on the year.
So he cut that back. That was inside zone off the left. He cut it all the way back to the right. And that's where, you know, so if McQuarrie keeps the ball there, McQuarrie's got the same path to the end zone. That's what I'm talking about.
Yep.
They're vacating the quarterback side of that inside zone. Fike was able to fight back to that spot. But McQuarrie, if he pulls it on the inside zone, he's got the same kind of running room. Now, he ran to where McQuarrie would go had he kept the ball there.
5:55 left to play in the football game, trying to tie us up at 20. Awaiting the snap. Snap is good. The kick is up. The kick is good. We're tied at 20. Frontier Conference action. 5:55 left to play in the football game. And Rocky will get it back after this 1 minute timeout.
Born into extraordinary circumstances to live an extraordinary life. So what we want to do at Montana Tech is we want to put more students on that extraordinary path.
We take our students out of the classroom into the field.
Montana Tech promotes problem solvers, not problem makers.
They're able to adapt to pretty much any situation.
At Montana Tech, our students graduate and they go to work. They live the American dream. By supporting the Montana Tech Foundation, you're helping us put more students on that extraordinary path.
Back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech. End over end kick's going to go 8 yards deep, and the Battling Bears will start it off with the touchback. So the Bears offense will come back out. The Digger defense will give it another go.
Need a big defensive play here. Some kind of stop. Three and out's always good, but some kind of big defensive play. Something just to get the juices flowing a little more. Maybe like a blindside sack or some kind of tackle for loss or... Of course, turnovers always help.
Always a good thing. So right now, Rocky is 70 offensive plays for 371 yards. Melby has rushed the ball 14 times for 90 yards. Drew Korf through the air is 18 of 31 for 203 and two touchdowns, no interceptions. Korf out of the shotgun, first and 10 from the 25. One back, trips receivers. Korf eyeing up the defensive front. Korf looking to his right the whole way. The freshman airs it up, pass complete, but was he in bounds? And they'll say catch at the 35-yard line. First down yardage. Actually, they'll mark him at the 36 as a flying out of bounds with that catch for the Battling Bears. That's a nice catch that time by Schwartz.
No argument off the Tech sideline. It didn't look like he got him down from here, but we have to look through a few bodies. But no argument from the sideline. I mean... coaches, if they think he's out of bounds, they tend to let you know about it.
So Rocky, fresh set of downs at their 36-yard line. Korf out of the shotgun. Two receivers left. Handoff will go on the inside to Melby. Melby's off to the races. Melby's going to take it. He's at the 30, 20, 10. Melby will take it the distance. And Melby will go 64 yards for the score. And the Battling Bears back on top.
That just shows you inside zone. Running, you know, the yards are tough to come by. Eventually, something may pop, and it did that time for Melby. He cleared the line of scrimmage, then his wheels took care of the rest. 64 yards for six.
So Melby takes off, runs her 64 yards, and Rocky grabs the lead back. So Melby now goes up over 150 yards on the day. Rocky leading 26-20. The kick is up and good. 27-20. The Battling Bears up over Montana Tech. Frontier Conference action at Bob Green Field as Melby goes 64 yards. And now Montana Tech finds himself in a hole once again.
I believe the last guy to rush for over 150 yards in a game for against Montana Tech was Jed Fike.
I think it was Fike. Yeah, I believe it was Fike. So the Montana Tech offense will get another shot at it here, down by a score. So as it sits right now, Melby has 15 carries for 154 yards and a score. Rocky has rushed the ball 40 times for 232 yards. They have 446 yards on the day. 27-20, a 7-point lead for the Bears. And the Bears will kick it off here to Montana Tech. Just when it felt like Montana Tech had started to reel in some of that momentum, the Bears put the kibosh on it. So they spread out. Montana Tech's receiving unit does as well. And the Bears will kick it deep, end over end, 3 yards deep, no return. And Montana Tech will start it off at the 25.
I think if one thing's proven today is, I've been saying how good of a one-loss team Carroll was going into that last Tech game. I mean, I thought they were a good football team, obviously a good football team, because Rocky looks like a really good football team. I never anticipated this. Full disclosure, I never even anticipated Rocky coming in here and doing what they've done today. But, it's just a testament to why they play the game on Saturday, no doubt about it. They're fired up, and they're playing a really good football game. Offensive, especially in the offensive front, and we haven't talked about Rocky's offensive line, tight end through tackle, but they've done an exceptional job here today.
First and 10 for Macquarie and Company. Two receivers right, twin tight left. Man comes in motion. They're going to run that jet sweep around the corner, across the 25-30, out to the 31-yard line for Montana Tech. And with the carry is going to be Braxton Porter.
Porter getting in the game for a little fly sweep. And just a quicker way of attacking the outside via the outside zone. A good job up front blocking by the Montana Tech receiving corps. And Porter's able to pick up 6 yards.
Second down and 4 for the Digs. As Porter comes out, Macquarie has Fike in the backfield. Tight end left. Handoff is going to go to Fike. He's going to bounce it left. Turns the corner. He's across the 35, out of bounds at the 39. First down yardage plus some, as he'll get 9 yards on the carry, and that will move the chains for Tech with 4:41 left to play in the football game.
First things first, if you're Montana Tech, move this football, see a new set of downs, and eventually, you've got to tie this game. 4.5 minutes left, plenty of time in this football game, but you need a score.
Two receivers left, Sullivan comes in motion. Fike, nope, they're going to run screen out to Sullivan. Sullivan head down across the 40 to the 41. He takes a big hit but gets 2 positive yards as Sean Sullivan was deposited to the ground quickly.
Good block, nickelback that time. Kirk Dershin, 5'11", 200-pounder from Casper, Wyoming, via Chevron State.
Mason Melby, 15 carries for 154 yards for Rocky. Jed Fike, 21 carries for 134 for Montana Tech. Second down and 7 for Montana Tech. Trips receivers left, one to the right. Looks like Dion all by his lonesome all the way up top. Rocky showing blitz. Macquarie looks to the trip side. Downfield to Sullivan, across midfield to the Rocky 47. First down yardage and a gain of 13.
They've settled down and thrown the ball, just the controlled passing attack here better in the second half. Of course, they've seen the ball a little more here in the second half, but pass protection very good, keeping the pocket shallow and wide for their quarterback to get a look at 1, 2, sometimes 3 different receivers before that ball's released.
First down and 10 here for the Montana Tech Ore Diggers. 2 backs, 2 receivers. Fike goes in motion, releases out to the slot right side. Play action. Macquarie rolls. He wants pass back. Wide open down the field is Feisthamel. He gets hammered at the 35-yard line. Where's the taunting there? If we get a taunting call the other way, and a stepping up, making the stop that time was Kendall Jefferson.
Yeah, great play by Jefferson, and you're right. That's an emotional thing. In no way in my right mind would I say, that's taunting given the moment and whatnot. But, he's in the face of the defender that he just knocked on his rear end. That's the call that was made earlier in the game against Montana Tech, and you're right, it should have been made there.
Second down and 10, 4 receivers, 1 back at home, ball at the Rocky 47-yard line. Dropping back, Macquarie, pocket starts to collapse. He airs it up, comeback route, and making the catch is Chris LaChance at the Rocky 36-yard line. That's first down yardage, and a nice route by Chris LaChance.
Good coverage that time by by Jenkins again. Or not
Jefferson.
Or Jefferson, excuse me. Jefferson again. That's just a perfectly thrown ball by McQuarrie. Rocky's going to get a timeout here.
Rocky will call a timeout as they lead by a score, 27-20. With 2:52 left to play here in this football game, let's go ahead and keep it here and take a look at some of the numbers here. Montana Tech right now has run 56 offensive plays for 308 yards, just barely over half of their season average. They average over 600 yards of offense, and they sit at 308 right now. McQuarrie is 19 of 32. He has one touchdown but three interceptions and 184 yards on the day.
Yeah, it's been a tough day for McQuarrie. Really, really good effort top to bottom for Rocky Mountain. Secondary's had a nice day. They've had some chances at some 50-50 balls, and they've taken advantage of every opportunity, make good plays on them, get them at high point. You know, sometimes it was a physical one-on-one battle. They won the battle, and good aggressive secondary play, no doubt.
2:52 left to play here in this football game. Montana Tech with the ball at the Rocky 36. First and 10, trailing by a touchdown.
Right, you know, the Tech's hands are kind of tied. I mean, sure, you want to score and tie this game, but, you know, you don't want to score too quick, give the offense another. I mean, there's all those things to consider.
First down and 10, Montana Tech, four receivers, two on each side. McQuarrie out of the shotgun with Jed Fike in the backfield. Fike, 142 yards on the day. And now Montana Tech calls a timeout. Montana Tech calls a timeout. And that is their second timeout of the half. Not quite sure what went on there as the coaching staff came out and called a quick timeout after they had set up.
They got to visit about some things, but there still looked like there was some confusion once they got to the line of scrimmage, get the bluff count, see if they could get Rocky to tip their hat defensively. They all looked at the sideline, and they want to talk about it again.
So once again, first and 10 here for Montana Tech. They trail by a score, 27-20.
You know what I think they're doing?
What do you think they're doing?
I think they're trying to get Rocky to tip their hat, and they're going to try and take a poke at Deion one-on-one out there on the wide side of the field. That's
okay.
What I think.
Okay. There was four wide. So I would assume you had Deion, Sullivan, Kelly, and maybe LeChance. So we've got Sullivan and Deion going that way. We've got... looks like Chris Kelly and Chris LeChance here on the near side.
I don't know that you could get it just one-on-one, but with a double move, some kind of a, maybe a stomp, a jerk route. Is that what Gruden calls it, a jerk route?
McQuarrie drops back. Blitz is coming. McQuarrie in trouble. Tried to shovel it. He does get rid of it, and it will fall incomplete as McQuarrie is just hammered. Rocky gets three guys, almost four guys in the backfield.
Yeah, they brought plenty on that. Five or six on the rush. I couldn't tell. It looked like one of their nose tackles might have been trying to screen sniff a little bit. But nonetheless, they got a lot of guys in the backfield in a hurry.
Second down and 10. Trips receivers right, one to the left. McQuarrie, the hard count almost got him across. 2:47 remaining here in the football game. Montana Tech trails by a touchdown. The Digs, number 11 in the country. They sit in second place in the Frontier Conference. McQuarrie eyeing up the blitz. Slant route through the middle is complete to the 30-yard line. That's going to be a gain of six as they go to Sean Sullivan. And Sullivan picks up his ninth reception of the afternoon.
No doubt what you're doing here. I mean, you've got two downs to go get this first down. I'd be surprised if it isn't Fike.
McQuarrie to Fike. Fike straight up the middle. He's across the 25 to the 22-yard line. Jed Fike. With that strength of his, he'll pound it ahead for a gain of eight. He's at 150 yards on the day.
Regardless of what happens here today, win, lose, or draw, the effort that Jed Fike has made in this football game is, I think, to me, it surpasses certainly anything he's done all year, including the big day last year.
Yeah.
I mean, he's had to earn every yard. He's taken it to a different level today here as a Tech running back.
First down and 10, Montana Tech. Four wide, one back. McQuarrie has time. Pocket starts to collapse. He's going to run. He gets a blocker across the 15 down to the 11. The first time he's carried the ball today, and he'll get 11 on the scamper.
First down yardage, and they can still get a first down inside the 1 yard line. Plenty of time on the clock. Here at a minute 56.
So we're down, the clock is running, 1:50 left to play. As you mentioned, they can get a first down at the one. Montana Tech, two timeouts remaining.
McQuarrie's eyes went to the right side that time, but he had on a seam route or a skinny post, he had Chris Kelly down the middle of the field on the previous. His eyes just got to him too late.
Fike in the backfield, trips receivers lefts. McQuarrie going to go for the deep route to the back of the end zone. Touchdown, Deion Williams.
Double move.
Deion Williams to the back of the end zone. Montana Tech within one.
Double move in the little corner. Corner post there. To me, it doesn't look like there's enough room down there to run that, but Deion Williams ran that to perfection.
Deion Williams will get the reception, his third of the afternoon, and he'll get the points. Montana Tech will look to tie us up here with a PAT.
Really well-thrown ball that time by McQuarrie.
McQuarrie, 20 of 33 for 195. That's his second touchdown of the afternoon, and the kicking unit is in for the PAT, Derek Holt. Snap and hold, the kick is up, and the kick is good.
Good catch.
27 up, 128 left to play in the football game. Rocky will get the football back after this 1 minute break.
I love Butte. It's my hometown. I was born and raised here, and definitely part of my soul is here. At Montana Tech, we receive this world-class education that I don't feel a lot of other students receive, and it's so valuable and it's so affordable, so I think that it's a really big benefit to students that come here.
When I came to Montana Tech, I definitely felt inspired to work harder because you're surrounded by all of these incredibly hardworking people that are goal-oriented and they know exactly what they want to do. I think that just the type of students that get recruited here are you're driven, really pretty bright students, and when we all get in a room together, we just vibe off of each other, and it makes something really incredible. In preparing for dental school, I feel that I've gotten the best education possible through Montana Tech, and I feel well prepared, and I think that I have my...
4 yards deep, and they'll bring it out. Rocky with the return across the 10, 20, out to the 24-yard line.
Every second matters. Every second matters.
Ball came out. The Montana Tech saying they have that football, and the linesman says it is down.
Every second matters. You know, he could have took that ball and just kneeled on it in the end zone and got the ball at the 25. They chose to bring it out. Lost 5 seconds.
And Sam Sparks isn't moving his arm a whole lot.
Down, it usually means shoulder.
So Sparks, one of the three-headed monster at tailback, will go over and talk to the trainer. And again, still not moving his left arm at all.
Impressed with all three tailbacks at Rocky, yeah. Day, Olsen, Sparks, and of course Melby, the one that got away the most, but Melby's tough.
First down and 10 here for the Bears. Out of the shotgun is going to be Drew Korf. One back is Melby. Trips receivers left, one to the right. And the freshman calling the plays here for the Bears. Montana Tech brings five up to the defensive front. Korf looking left the whole way. Rifle shot to the slot, complete across the 30, out to the 35. First down yardage and a gain of 11. They'll stop the clock long enough to move the chains.
Yeah, they just clear. They clear like a, almost like a clear, a fade with the inside slot, and then just replace on a quick slant with their wide out. They've done it all day long and been really successful.
Clock is running. 105 left to play here in the football game. We're tied up 27 apiece. Out of the shotgun, Korf looking left, checks it. Looking through the middle. Rifle pass is caught, bobbled, but brought in. Nice catch that time by Max Gray, and that's going to be a pickup of 13 out to the Rocky 47-yard line and good for another first down. Boy, Korf's throwing motion is really low, especially when he throws across the middle. First down and 10. Clock running. 46 seconds. Four-man pressure. Korf goes right, and looks like it is caught at the Montana Tech 49-yard line.
Yeah, Jenkins hasn't been in yet this series. The big tight end, that time going to the other tight end when they go too tight.
82, Brandon Mosley.
Yeah, Brandon Mosley.
So second down and 6 for the Lights.
Another California guy.
And this kicking unit for Rocky is awfully good. I'd be interested to know what their... what their limit is here today. Second down and 6 at the Montana Tech 49. 41 seconds left to play. Korf drops in the pocket. Pump fake. Now he's going to be forced to run. He's hit at midfield. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. And the clock is running. Rocky has 2 timeouts, and I would assume we'll get one here, and that's the case.
Better coverage that time by Montana Tech. Just rushed 4. Stayed back in coverage. Did a nice job of absorbing the crossing routes there. They collisioned 1. And Korff's eyes went to the middle of the football field, and the receiver that was supposed to be there was not there.
So Rocky Mountain College calls their second timeout. They have one remaining with 29 seconds left to play in this football game. We're tied up 27 apiece.
That's what outside linebacker Drew Schliemann, he used to do a great job of erasing crossing routes. I mean, he used to just position himself. They try and cross the field on him, and they either lay him on their keister or redirect him.
Trying to take a look at... So Griff Ames, the kicker for the Battling Bears, is 9 of 12 on field goals on the year. His long made is 38 yards.
Yeah, and if you're Tech here defensively, you have to be careful of a couple different things. You may want to pressure the quarterback, but if you bring a big pressure, Rocky's happy to go to overtime, just like Tech would be.
Yep.
There's still Melby in the backfield, still an option. So if you bring the house and you run inside zone, if it pops, it's over. It's over. He will literally, in man coverage, he will run to the end zone.
Third down and 5 here for the Bears. Out of the shotgun, Korff, one back, 3 receivers right, 1 of the left. Montana Tech showing pressure, and they will bring it. Korff on the right slant, complete across the 40, 35, down to the Montana Tech 31-yard line. The slant pass goes out into the hands of Overton.
They're
going
to punch it here.
And the Bears get up to the line of scrimmage. They'll wait for the clock to set, and then they do spike the football. With 21 seconds left to play here in the contest, they have one timeout remaining. Second and 10 from the Montana Tech 31-yard line. From here, it would be a 48-yard field goal. They have made a 38-yarder thus far on the year. They're 9 of 12 in the field goal department.
Yeah, he has a leg for it. Griff Ames, is it, the kicker?
Yep.
He's got the leg for it. He's put a couple, 5-8 yards deep into the end zone. That's with a pretty good run. But, this has got to be kind of at the tip of his range, I would think.
Second down and 10, Korff out of the shotgun. He'll hand it off up the middle. Melby will get a couple positive yards. He'll get to the 28-yard line. That's going to be a gain of 3. Clock still running. We're down to 10 seconds. Down to 6 seconds. So they're going to let it go and call a timeout right at the end and give him a shot. So they do. They stop it with 1.9 seconds left to play. And they're going to give it a go. So Rocky will call a timeout, and they're going to attempt a field goal to win this thing here in Butte, Montana. The ball rests at the 27-yard line. It would be a 44-yard attempt. You'd think about 7 yards back. That's my guess is where this will end up, a 44-yard attempt if they bring in the kicking unit.
Yeah, they will. They'll take a swing at it. Ames is 2 for 3 on the day. He missed his opener of the day. He yanked one to the right side of the goalpost, but he's been really accurate since and really met the ball well since. I mean, he might have to try and drive this one a little bit, so that tells you, like, if you're Brock Beatty, James Foote, a couple of those 6'5 guys on that defensive front, you got to try and get in that backfield and get them hands up.
So here comes the kicking unit. They'll put it down right at the 35-yard line, so a 45-yard attempt dead center of the field. 1.9 seconds remaining in this football game.
Check may ice in here.
And the snap and hold are good. The kick is up. It looks like it has legs, and it is good. Rocky gets it through, and Rocky will get the win. 30-27 is the final as the Battling Bears will take down Montana Tech here at Bob Green Field.
Yeah, it's just execution. That was a good final drive, and you got to tip your hats to them. They came in and played 4 quarters of really, really solid football here today. Ended it, put it on the legs of their kicker, no doubt. I mean, I don't think you got to come over and taunt like you're doing over there. You're on the visitor's side, or you're on the home team's field. But, yeah, hats off to them. They played a really quality football game, had some great individual efforts, the top to bottom, a coaching staff that was prepared and a bunch of players that were prepared.
30-27, our final score, as the Battling Bears hit a 45-yard field goal at the horn to take the win here in Butte, Montana. So let's do this. We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll wrap up the game. We'll give you the numbers, talk about what is ahead here for Montana Tech after this 2-minute timeout.